I want people to believe me when they taste my beer. That's what it's about.
You mean you laid underneath it and tried to
put his tongue up the bung?
I like to actually scoop up the yeast and look at it.
7 o'clock came real early that next morning.
Oh, yeah, man. Thanks for dumbing that down for us. You did an awesome job.
It's all about food and beer. You
punch me in the junk.
Man, that thing was thick.
The point is, just beat it like it's your dick.
I like to smell it afterwards.
Are you being sarcastic right now?
No. Bring your body armor.
I ran into my junk once on a ball valve on the kettle.
That's a true happy ending.
Now, live from the Brewing Network studios in Northern California, this is the radio program for home brewers, craft brewers, beer lovers, and beer geeks. It's your only source for live beer radio that brings expert brewers together with, well, expert drinkers. This is the radio program with a head on it. This is The Session.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to The Session. I'm your host, Justin Crosley. And with me today, we've got JP.
Hi.
Jason JP Petros.
Yes.
Teresa Pasuti is back in the studio.
Hello.
And Beverly.
Hello.
Beverly is here today.
Bevo is off. Beverly is filling in for me.
Beverly is here.
Yes. Boy, am I
handsome
late to this show. I apologize for making everybody wait. It took an inordinate amount of time to get back from Sonoma County. I don't know why. There's accidents everywhere, apparently. So now I'm drinking a Sonoma Pride from Russian River Brewing Company.
That's right.
Which is a charity beer, as a matter of fact. We donate all of the proceeds from this beer to Sonoma and for the fires and the victims and the help that Russian River is doing up there.
Hey, man, it's a place so nice that it wanted to keep you in it longer.
It almost did.
Yeah. It's like, no, it's like the person that hugs too long.
Yeah.
It was that.
I never like that person.
Yeah, well.
It's it's always so uncomfortable when you let go and they don't.
Yeah.
And then you have to reapply your own pressure.
Yeah.
And Charlie, you know when to let go of a hug, right? You never hang in there too long. Let's try the other microphone. That one's been giving me trouble.
Uh-oh.
Troubles. Yeah. Golly darn.
Gosh darn it, darn it, darn it, darn it, darn.
Can you hear me now?
There we go.
It's a little better.
I can't hear anything through these headsets.
Turn. Here, it looks like it's the volume's down right there. Okay.
So this one?
Yep. Oh, here we go. Good.
Okay. I don't want to blow out your ears.
I can't hear you too well out of that one, though.
Yeah?
I have to make you move all the way down to the end, Charlie.
Right.
This is what happens when I'm late. Can't fix.
How are we now?
It's okay, but you're not your usual.
No, well, I'll move.
Yeah, let's try this one the way over here at the end.
All right.
And I bet that can make you sound good on that
make
one.
Make sure that box is there. You go. Hell yeah. All right, Charlie. Let's try this now. Let's see what happens here, bud.
I bet you're going to sound golden.
That's better.
Yeah, that's better.
Yes.
Okay.
So you missed the girl's what I said actually.
Yeah, I did. That's what you said.
Something to do with hugging, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. You're not one of those I hug too long guys.
No.
You know when to.
Because I'm English. I'm English, and I just have a quick handshake.
Right. That makes sense.
And then wave you away.
Yeah. No inordinate hugging or emotion or anything really.
Women. I hug women.
Okay. That's
but
fair.
I don't hug men.
Yeah.
Unless we've scored a goal.
Okay, sure. Makes sense. That's a good rule.
Yeah. I have a good friend who's a very long hugger. And and I've known him forever, and it's always very uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So now I'm sort of like, every time I see him, I know he's going to want a hug.
Right.
And then I know I'm going to be there for a long time. So
you
I'm just
talk
sort
about
of like
Terrence.
No. Shay, my friend Shay.
Mm-hmm.
And he's been on the show. And so I just sort of like I accept it.
Right.
Because I tried to pull away and he doesn't go away. He's very European, I guess, or whatever. I don't know.
You don't like quick put a beer in your hand and give him the side hug.
No. He would literally take the beer out of my hand.
He would take the beer.
Yeah, because he's very just, you know, he's an embraceful man, and that's fine, and it's cool, and it's very nice, and it feels weird, but it goes on too long.
Yeah, I never liked that.
So Sam is a really long hugger.
What?
Sam? I know.
Since when?
Because I think he knows it bothers me. Yeah. Because I like will pull away and he like won't let go and I'm like, I just go limp.
I feel like Sam does it ironically.
That must Maybe. Be.
Well, I. He's who trolling. Does Sam hug though, other than me?
Well, but I hugged him. You're his wife, so.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, but I'm like, can you not?
Taryn's the same way with me.
We're married. I just don't want to be like that close to you.
Yeah. I'm like, I don't want to hug. Why are you hugging me? What did I do wrong? Right. I don't know. Good morning, Jason.
Oh, in the morning? No. I just want to be left alone.
Yeah.
So I am alone, and that's good.
Now you don't have any hugs.
Right.
I will hug you if you want.
Well, if you haven't guessed, our guest today is Dr. Charlie Bamforth is back in the studio with us.
Yeah. How nice to be here.
And the last time we spoke to Charlie was just before your retirement. And now you're fully into your retirement, I believe.
Well, I'm fully into retirement from the day job at UC Davis.
But okay.
I'm not fully into retirement. So I'm still usefully employed.
Well, we're going to dive into all of that in just a few moments and find out what you've been up to lately.
Good.
I knew you couldn't sit around doing nothing for too long.
No, my wife wouldn't let me.
Yeah, otherwise, you would.
You know, in Japan, women call their husbands big dust. Because, you know, and they're too difficult to sweep away. So they,
I see.
I don't intend to become big dust.
But if you could, you would just sit around watching soccer all day, wouldn't you?
No.
No?
No, I sit around writing about soccer all day, but and I might watch a bit. But,
okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But I'm doing all the things that I'm doing.
Okay. Well, we're going to find out about all of that in just a few moments. Today's episode brought to you by More Beer. You go to morebeer.com and check them out and thank them for being a sponsor of this show for 15 years they've been doing it. So give them a big thanks. Go to morebeer.com and check it out. Let me get through just a couple of announcements. Mostly, it is to save the date for Saturday, March 28th. That's our 11th annual Spring Brews Festival in Concord, California.
Was it June 28th?
March 28th. Teresa, did you get your invite?
I did. I was actually so excited that someone remembered to invite me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good job, guys.
I was like, and I almost did forget. And I was like,
oh man,
I think it was,
I would have just laughed.
As I would have too. I think it was Eric actually who reminded me. And I was like, oh my God, can you imagine if I didn't invite Teresa?
All the slots are full.
Yeah. I'd be like,
you
sorry.
Yeah, I can't. You can't put a table out. No, I can't. The park's too full.
You can just come and walk around. That's what I've been told that before.
Right.
Like when I don't get invited, they're like, you can just come.
Yeah. And you're like, that's you, not
and walk
what's,
around.
Yeah.
I'm like, thanks.
No. Yeah, I don't want to do that.
Yeah,
are you gonna make it?
I am. I see a conflicting thing on my calendar, but okay. I think I can make it work.
Great.
I think I can maybe do.
Well, I think you both. Have to make it work.
Well, yeah.
You have to.
I kind of have to.
Right?
Yeah. You know, because all I mean, all the people will be lined up by the take a picture with Teresa booth, and if I'm not there, it's gonna be kind of a shame.
Yeah. We should actually have one of those.
Yeah, we will now.
Yeah.
Write that
neon
down, Bebo. Take a picture with Teresa booth.
Okay, well, at least we'll have a cutout or something, and then you can awkwardly hug the cutout as long as you like.
Oh, that would be nice.
All right, so yeah, save the date. It's Saturday, March 28th, next year, as a matter of fact. Yeah,
that is a matter of fact.
All right, and the other announcement I have for you is as you're doing your holiday shopping, please do think of us and click the Amazon link. It's right on our homepage. I put a big, giant photo of a gift on the homepage, and it says shop with Amazon. You click that, and it'll take you through to Amazon. You could do all your shopping like you normally do, and as an affiliate, we get a little piece of the action. So we would love it if you support us that way this holiday season.
That's right. We get our beak wet.
Yeah. You can also subscribe and support us that way by joining the BN Army. Just click the donate button on the homepage. And for as little as $2 a month, you're entered into the More Beer Monthly Donation Giveaway, which is a chance to win $100 to spend over at More Beer. And the more you donate, the more entries you get. So thanks to all of you who have supported us that way, and we appreciate it very much. All right. Get updates and information and keep tabs on us over on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Send your feedback to feedback@thebrewingnetwork.com. com, and we love to hear your show ideas and anything you'd like to say to us. You can write us love notes and hate mail. We like all of it. Feedback at thebrewingnetwork.com. All right.
We've also got an equal amount of both.
Of love and hate?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wonder if we went back through all of the archives of feedback.
What the ratio would be?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
I think it's 60-40 or 80-20. 80-20 was always a safe, but 60-40, I think.
In which direction?
I think in favor of us? Yeah, I think for the most part.
I would have gone the opposite.
Yeah.
You know? A lot of times people only write about anything when they're upset, you know?
I was going to say, if you did it like pound for pound, I bet the negative feedback is going to weigh
more.
More.
Yeah, I think you're right about that.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, I'll put Bev right on that.
Yeah, I'll go through every email for 15 years.
I quit.
All right. Do we have a Twitter game today?
Sure. We can call it that. Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. How about Twitter game is brought to you today by Beersmith. You can go to beersmith.com and check out the Beersmith brewing software. You get a free 21-day trial. So if you don't like it, you can just not pay for it. And you can write hate mail to me that I led you astray about the best brewing software on the market called Beersmith. Go to beersmith.com. What's our Twitter game?
Well, you know what? I was thinking here on the way over to the show, Jay, about trying to learn something new.
Were you now?
Yeah, I was. Okay. I'd like to learn something. I feel like a very stagnant. You know, I tried to learn a guitar, but it was like, well, what's the point? I'm never going to be in a band.
When do you think the last time that you learned something new was?
Oh, I don't know. It's probably something having to do with like my podcast or some dumb crap like that, right? Mm-hmm, just some... Mm-hmm. How do I stream this thing or whatever? But like a skill.
Okay.
Who knows? I have literally no idea. Right. I couldn't tell you. Yeah. Maybe walking.
Right.
I think
that's the last time.
Yeah. Okay. But like when I'm playing guitar, it's a bass guitar. So it's not like you can actually pull out a bass guitar around a campfire or with a party.
Sure.
And start playing the guitar. It's because, you know, what are you going to do? No one's going to recognize a song.
No, no one cares.
No one cares unless it's like Money by Eddie Murphy. No.
Right.
Pink Floyd.
There you
go. This is the same thing.
Yeah.
So I thought today it's more of a serious take. If you had to learn a skill, or if you could learn any skill in the world, what would it be?
Okay.
Anything.
Me or just anybody?
Anybody.
What's the skill that they would learn?
And it's, you know.
This sounds like a serious one. It's not even a funny Twitter
game. No, it's not even fun. I'm not really feeling very funny today.
I see.
Yeah. Okay. I feel very, like, down.
Is it because you knew we had a UK guest on? You figured you had to, like, serious things up a little bit?
Yes. Yeah. My dry humor isn't working, so I just went very serious.
Okay. Yeah. Right. You didn't, like, watch Monty Python first or anything like that.
That might have really helped, honestly.
Yeah, I should have done, but. I didn't. I watched 3 episodes of Sesame Street today.
Okay.
So,
right.
Put my head through a wall.
Do you want to tell Charlie that you have a child, or just let him think you were watching Sesame Street on your own?
I knew that. Okay. I knew that. Okay. I'm a Facebook friend.
Oh, yes, there we go.
I knew that.
All right.
Thank you, Charlie.
Yeah.
Marisha Hagate.
That's right.
Yeah. So there you go.
All right. What skill would you learn?
Sure.
That's our Twitter game today.
Like, without any sort of training, just if you could just, bam, upload a skill, boom, what would it be?
Yeah.
What would you want to learn? Like, welding? Trigonometry? I don't know.
It definitely wouldn't be trigonometry.
Podiatry?
Yeah.
You want to be a podiatrist?
Mm. Is that a skill? That's a profession.
There's skill to it, and it's very underrated profession, is my opinion.
You can scrape a living doing that.
Yeah, just a little. All right, very good. Send in your answers, and we'll pick a winner later.
Sure.
Yeah. All right, let's do some feedback. Feedback is brought to you today by...
It's very hot in here.
It's a little balmy.
The Beer Law Center. You can go to beerlawcenter.com, and John takes care of things for me on the trademark side. And in fact, he's probably going to have to do a hell of a lot more work after today.
Really? Again, every app we're talking about.
Today was my deadline to answer their latest offer, and I kind of blew it off. I kind of forgot about it. So.
Today was the deadline they gave you, and you forgot.
Yeah, but okay. I was pretty much thinking I was going to tell them just to fuck off and sue me anyway.
Yeah.
So I kind of think it matters. I'll do it tomorrow.
That's
and
what
then
I'm saying.
And then John at the Beer Law Center is going to have to go to work for me.
Yeah.
Again. Go to beerlawcenter.com. Okay. In our feedback this week, there's a lot of feedback. People have been writing in lately, huh?
People have been writing, and it's been a very good, I would even say, month for feedback. People are hunkering down and sort of expressing themselves. via the format of email, which stands for electronic.
Yes.
Email.
Do I really not read this, don't read this part on air part?
I didn't even see that. Sorry. God, I'm so bad. I apologize.
It looks like maybe. I don't know. Anyway,
don't read it.
Lynn writes the first part, I guess I can go through.
Yeah, I apologize. Let me go through.
Lynn writes in, I've been going through the session episodes for the third time, I guess.
What an insane person.
Yeah.
This person is insane.
And he says, going back to when Justin got starstruck by meeting the singer of the Black Crowes, I had to really reflect on my respect level. I paused the episode to listen to some of their songs. And for God's sake, Justin, the music is not good.
Lynn speaks for the children, for sure.
I thought you knew good music, promoting Lucas Ohio and even the Trophy Fire, Schumann's band, he says is way better. I'm sad that the timeline worked this way. If you would have been there for the Toasted Barrel Brewery interview, I would have ridiculed you mercilessly. Is he in Toasted?
Lynn was the brewer at Toasted Barrel.
Got it. Yeah.
Good beers.
Anyway, he goes on and on and on and on and on.
but you know what? I feel like this is how insane he is.
Yeah.
Because he thinks the Trophy Fire
right.
is better than the Black Crowes. And I'm not a Black Crowes fan.
Right.
I'm a Trophy Fire fan, and I think they suck compared to the Black Crowes.
They do.
That's how bad my taste is.
I don't know many people who don't like at least one Black Crowes song. Like, even if you're not a fan, like, everyone knows a song, listens to a song, doesn't. So, I don't know what Lynn's talking about. And I will have you know, Lynn, that the Black Crowes are actually getting back together. So you can catch them on tour if you want.
I'm sure he'll be there.
And I still cringe every time I think about how I fanboyed when I met Chris Robinson.
Yeah.
I still cringe. Like, I hate that I was such a douchebag
met
him.
What I find helps when any sort of embarrassing situation happens is just to think about it nonstop, constantly.
This
is what I do, too.
I remember things
really
from,
helps.
Like, the sixth grade that I think about, and they bother me.
For sure. Yeah. And it's healthy just to keep replaying all those moments.
I think
Charlie,
that's normal. I do that, too.
Really?
Yeah, it's really uncomfortable.
It is uncomfortable.
Yeah. It's fun.
And I'll visibly get...
You, like, cringe. You know, it's so cringy.
I think we talked about on the show, when that happens, if I start singing or, randomly start talking, that's how I'm trying to, like, kick my brain off of
bad thought.
Yeah, of going, you know, remember that time? I mean, it just that happened in your life. And you go, well, yeah, I know. It happened. You're dumb.
Yeah. I need a chance to meet Chris Robinson again so I can make up for it.
You really do, because I'm sure this time it'd be so much better.
Yeah.
I think you're in a better space.
Yeah. All right. Well, Lynn, thanks for writing in, even though you're stupid. okay. So Kevin writes in, I just wanted to say that I agree with Justin's assessment of the New Belgium sale. Though the details are vague and I don't know what the motivation to sell was, it comes down to the employees deciding to sell their business. I guess Kevin is from Fort Collins. He says, living here in Fort Collins and knowing people who not only work there but own, deciding to sell is somewhat sad because it's the end of their run in the craft beer world. In the end, it all comes down to business, and I think they made a business move that was a good decision, and it was their decision. He says, I heard a lot of people shitting on them for selling out and claiming that they'll never buy New Belgium beer again. But he says, I won't do that. Instead, I will raise my glass to them and cheers them. They've had an amazing run, and they're walking away with money in their pockets. New Belgium was a unique leader in the industry, craft industry early on. So they've made world-class beer, and I don't know, blah, blah, blah. He's all for it.
Well, they're not even walking away with money in their pockets. They still have a job.
Yeah, they didn't. They didn't leave.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just they just
they
have money
off
in their pockets.
In a year, yeah, but
yeah.
Well, I just kind of wonder how does this. It was Kieran that bought them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's just been such a bad track record of these big companies that buy these breweries, regional breweries that are storied in craft beer history, and things just have been going way downhill. So you kind of wonder, you know.
Will this one be any different?
Yeah. I mean, what is going to make it different?
Yeah.
The fact that the employees decided to do it and we're all going to forgive them, or are people going to still turn away from them?
Yeah. I don't know. And I'm trying, you know, out here on the West Coast, I wouldn't say that New Belgium is a fan favorite of anybody's anyhow, like hasn't been for a while. Yeah. So I don't think I really have my finger on the pulse of who the New Belgium drinker is. Except that whenever I was in Fort Collins, I would drink New Belgium, and I loved going to the brewery tasting room, and they always had great beer there. And our friend Lauren Salazar,
yeah.
Actually, I think it's a different last name now. Forgive me, Lauren.
Oh. Well, congrats to her.
Sour beer, their sour beer master. She made some wonderful creations.
Yeah.
So I don't know what's gonna happen. Do you have any opinion on this, Charlie?
This type of thing is a very difficult area for me because, obviously, I've been associated with big guys and small guys
right.
from time to time. So, you know, what I will say is a few things. You know, the Japanese brewing companies, Kirin and Asahi, they're very responsible. They're absolutely meticulous.
Yeah.
Everything's done to fine detail. So in terms of the technology and the technical stuff, it's probably going to get better and better.
Yeah.
But it's always that difficulty about whether it really is sort of on a level playing field and whether the big guys have got the advantage because of the financial clout and so on. So I feel very torn about it. When people, I remember talking to somebody once and totally on a different company. Somebody said to me once, I love Blue Moon.
Hmm.
And I said, yeah, it's a good Coors product. She said, I hate Blue Moon.
Instantly, yeah.
This was within 10 seconds, you know.
Right.
And really, the judgment about quality is very different from the sort of the message, the storyline, the, you know, where does your heart sit on these sorts of things. So I'm always torn by this.
Yeah.
My good friend Logan Plant in London sold 49% of his business to Heineken, and suddenly people wouldn't drink his beer. It's bizarre, you know. So I really, you know, I'm gonna upset some people, and it doesn't matter. You know, I can't blame people if they want to actually realize their investment, you know, in some way. I really can't, and I don't think many people would turn that away. There are some who would,
yeah,
and who would never get bought out, but
sure,
many will, and I don't think it makes them bad people.
So, Charlie, that's my sentiment exactly. I've been saying that on this show since the Ballast Point buyout because I feel like it's kind of the American dream. You know, you start a tiny company. I think New Belgium's actually a great example. I believe they started it out of their garage in Fort Collins there and built it into this, obviously, you know, multi-million dollar brewery. And I think that's the American dream.
Yeah.
You know.
There are some bad things that happen in some very large brewing companies, and there's some very horrible business practices that I'm aware of and won't go into.
Okay.
And I don't approve of that.
Mm-hmm.
But if you just stick to the beer, the beer itself, I don't think the quality of the beer will go down at all.
Yeah.
And, you know, chances are it might be even better.
Sure. Could happen. All right. Says Charlie.
That's right.
What
stamp of approval.
Kevin ends by saying on a side note, sorry to say goodbye to the Hop Grenade in Fort Collins. He's going to be there for our Closing the Doors party. Yeah, we're throwing a party. We're shutting down our Hop Grenade Fort Collins. Our last day will be December 28th. And, you know, I'm not letting a little thing like going out of business stop me from throwing a party.
From going into business.
So
from making money.
So we're throwing a kick the keg party. We've got some beer to get through, and we hope you'll help us if you're out in northern Colorado.
Sounds fun, man.
I will be there. And Saturday, December 28th is our last day. So come join us. Spend some money, will you? let's see. Carlin writes in, Justin, since you're looking for cool places to visit on your U.S. tour next year, I suggest you hit up Union Craft Brewing in Baltimore, Maryland. They've got a newer facility, and they call it a collective. It houses their brewery and a ton of other businesses, like a rock climbing place, an ice cream shop, a distillery,
Jesus.
A pizza place, and a coffee roaster.
Wow. You can rent a flat there for $1,000 a month. two-year lease terms.
Yeah.
Let's see. You drink coffee, you eat ice cream, drink your craft beer, and then you go climbing.
Yeah. They have
what could go wrong?
They have a community car you can borrow.
Of course.
You must bear four children before you leave.
Their beers are really good, Carlin says. Blah, blah, blah.
Please go rock climbing. If you go to that weird-ass place, please go rock climbing. Yeah, and video it.
After I drink, right?
During.
Yeah.
You, you know what? Yeah. I have one of those hard hats with the two cans on the side. So drink.
Perfect.
I will. You need to wear that because safety third. Yeah. You know that we've talked about that. What state is it in?
Maryland.
Oh, I was going to say I was going to go, but that's too far away.
Maryland. But he does say, actually, I don't know if Carlin is a he or a she. They say that I should bring you their Skipjack Pilsner.
Okay.
And then they say, speaking of JP, if you come out this way, I could offer to stand in for him on the podcast.
Well, Carlin, I have bad news for you. I sit down during the podcast, so you're already way out of the loop.
Carlin says, I've been running my own craft beer podcast for the past 8 years.
Mm. Whoa.
And is very happy to rail against hazy IPAs.
Well, then you might fit in. You might fill this big bright tank that you call a second chair, Justin.
Okay. Yes. Could happen.
It could.
I don't know.
It could.
Should I give his podcast a plug? His or her? Their podcast?
I wouldn't do it.
It's called the
Beep
Podcast. Wait, I don't think I said it right. It's called the
Boop
Podcast. I think it's called the Brutal, like brutal, but it's spelled B-R-E-W.
Yeah.
The Brutal Battle Podcast.
Hell yeah, dude. Oh, Punisher style. Yeah. Redo it.
So check it out.
Yeah, check it out. Throw the guy a like, man. Why not?
Or she.
Fucking throw everyone a like, dude. I don't know. Just go down iTunes and rate every podcast.
There we go. All right, Jay writes in, shout out to The Session. I stumbled across this program a while back while I was trying to get info on Pizza Port's brewing technique, and I've been a fan ever since. It's definitely lowered my brewing handicap a few strokes, if you know what I mean.
I don't either.
Drinking a Grenadier, and this beer rocks. Yeah, that's the collaboration beer that we did with Firestone Walker. Mm-hmm. It has our logo on it. Mm-hmm. We could not call it Hop Grenade because I'm being sued.
Right.
But we can use my logo because I own it.
Yeah.
And the beer is awesome. Thank you for saying that, Jay. I agree with you. He says, definitely as much flavor as you'll find anywhere in a 4.9% pale. So he says, here's some requests for breweries that, he'd like to see on the show. Bob from Highland Park.
Okay.
So Highland Park, I guess.
All right. Not just Bob.
Evan from Green Cheek. We had Evan on.
We did.
When Evan was with Noble.
That's right. I thought we had Green Cheek on.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
No.
They do some weird shit, man.
Yeah, I will say this. I don't think I've ever had a bad beer from Evan. He is one hell of a brewer.
Yeah.
Yeah, he makes some good stuff. We had his stuff this year at Firestone, too.
Correct.
And really, really good. Jay thinks that Evan makes the best IPA in the world, according to this.
Apparently he's had them all and can make that judgment.
Yeah. And then Fall Brewing out of San Diego.
Okay.
And then these ones are weird, and I guess they're from California. Enegrin and Epig. E-P-P-I-G. Was he drunk writing, you think? I've never heard of
Enegrin. I've heard of Epig.
He's probably text, you know, speech to texting.
Yeah.
Tell them Epig. Jeez, it's real good.
Gosh. Yeah. Okay, anyway, thank you for writing in, Jay. I appreciate it. And then finally, here's one from Dennis.
Apologies to Epig if there is a real brewery out there.
I know, apparently. Don't mean to make fun. Forgive me, Enegrin and
funny.
Epig.
Yeah.
That should be one brewery.
Enegrin, or a law firm, or...
yeah.
It sounds kind of like a pub also, to be honest.
It does sound a little bit like a pub.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right.
Whatever.
Dennis writes in...
Hi, Dennis. Thank you for the nice name.
Today, my wife and I had some time to kill in Elk Grove, California, I assume.
Oh.
Figured we'd stop by Flatland Brewing. They've been on the show.
Yes.
As I sat at the brewery going through my tasting flight, I heard what sounded like a familiar voice, and I looked behind the bar and saw a man talking to a customer, and I thought to myself, was this the asshole that lost the trophy? That's right. They lost the California Craft Brewers Association trophy, right?
They lost the Guild Cup, the best Guild of California Cup.
Yeah.
And then they named a beer after it.
That's right. Yeah, this brewery won this award, no. And then got so drunk that night that they lost the trophy.
No, it was the guild. This brewery was very responsible and put her trophy in her hotel room.
That's right. That was you.
Yes.
The guild that won.
Guild.
And
the
lost.
Guild was somewhat less responsible.
And the trophy is supposed to get passed on year to year.
Yeah.
But it's now gone because they lost it. Anyhow, let's see what he said. After a few minutes, the man came out, and I asked him if he was the guy that lost the trophy that was talked about in the Brewing Network, and he gracefully bowed his head and said yes. He says it was Andrew, by the way. He was such a nice guy. Talked with me and my wife for 30 minutes or so. Talked about the show and about he says calibration, but I think it was a collaboration beer.
Celebration.
Yeah, it could have been, yeah. That they did with Crooked Lane.
Yay, yeah.
Drinking that before the show.
I know, and I brought a bunch of it.
Okay.
Because it's my new favorite beer in the world.
Really?
It's seriously my new favorite beer that we've ever done.
Got it.
And I know Andrew really loves it too. We haven't seen each other in person, but there's going to be a really long, awkward hug.
Oh,
there's
right.
going to be a moment.
Oh, because of this beer?
Because we're so excited about this beer. It's so good.
This beer called Less Ford, More Ferrari Pilsner. Is that it?
That's
what
it.
You're drinking there? I'll get some at the break. Teresa, thank you, though, Bebo. Dennis just says thanks to Andrew and Flatland for such a great time. They now have a loyal customer.
You need a dog called Pickles.
Pickles.
Because in 1966, in England, they lost the World Cup. And it was found by a dog called Pickles.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
What team won it?
I think England won that year.
Okay.
In fact, I know England won
where,
that year.
Where was it found? Do you remember?
In somebody's front garden.
Okay.
Under a bush.
I think that sounds about right.
Hell yeah.
I think the dog pissed on it first. And then
yeah.
Oh, my God.
That's usually where we find Bebo's husband after a night of drinking, on somebody's front lawn
getting
under a bush.
On by a dog.
Yeah, yeah.
So they took it out partying and
No, somebody stole it.
Oh, somebody stole it.
This is the Jules Rimet trophy. This is a beautiful, but luckily they found it again. It would be very embarrassing because Bobby Moore wouldn't have had anything to hold.
Wow, yeah. It would be such a shame.
Yeah.
Is it still the same trophy today?
No, they got rid of it.
Okay. I see. After that, I got pissed on. So,
yeah.
You'd think you could just wash it off and just.
I don't think that was the reason why. But
sure.
they got a bigger one.
I'm reading a little bit about it on Wikipedia. It's actually very fascinating.
Really?
Someone stole the cup. It was on a display case. A telephone call from a man who called himself Jackson called the chairman of Chelsea Football Club and then said that their package would be left at Stamford Bridge the following day with a ransom note. But the guy who made the phone call was caught. And then he said, no, it wasn't me. I'm the middleman. The real person, someone called the Pole and has never been identified.
Really?
That's actually really fascinating.
Interesting.
The Pole.
Yeah.
Okay. Dennis says, P.S., after talking to Andrew about a growler collection that I have, he went into his storage and pulled out a glass growler for me to take home that they don't sell anymore.
That's very nice.
Yeah.
Parting with the old antiques there.
What else?
He is a nice guy.
I threw away so many growlers when we moved. I mean, just...
He also gave him, gifted him a four-pack of the collaboration beer.
No way!
So Andrew was being real nice to our listeners over there.
He is a stand-up dude.
Just more than I can say for us, really.
Yeah. So. We'll just make fun of you.
Yeah, I have so many growlers, and I never. I go to breweries semi-often. I never remember to bring a growler with me, ever.
No, well, and then, especially after California sort of made that rule where you can bring in any growler now,
mm-hmm.
right? So that opened it up to anything, but even going to like the Rare Barrel or a place where you'd want to get like a growler, like a half growlers.
Yeah.
And I don't remember to bring it. I don't remember to bring anything.
Exactly. And then I'm not going to like buy another one because I already own one. So then I just don't get a growler.
Yeah.
That's basically what
happens.
That's
how I wind up with six Russian River growlers and I don't need
Exactly.
I just threw everything away.
I had so many Russian River growlers at one point. Partly because Vinny had done the show several times,
yes.
That he asked for them back. He came and did the show one time, and he saw my collection, and he was like, so listen, I hate to do this, but we're running a little low at the brewery. And I had all of them.
Yeah,
I think he took home like seven growlers or something. I felt
bad. Pickup truck, yeah.
But yeah. Anyhow, Andrew, thanks for being nice to Dennis. Dennis, thanks for writing in and telling us that story. And that is our feedback for today.
Andrew, thanks for being nice for Dennis. Dennis, thanks for being nice to Teresa. Teresa, yes. Thanks for being nice to Andrew.
Yes. And John from the Beer Law Center, thank you for hopefully keeping me from losing my pants in the lawsuit that you'll surely hear about tomorrow morning.
Thanks
for when I call you.
Thanks for being nice to Justin, and thanks for being mean to Boo.
Yes, exactly. All right, we're going to take a very quick break, and when we come back, Charlie Bamforth, Dr. Charlie Bamforth, that is, right here on The Session. Hang in there, and we'll be right back.
Just don't believe you. I'm not alive.
segment is brought to you by the 21st Amendment Brewery. That's right, and their latest seasonal release, Tasty IPA, is still on the shelves. And, of course, that was made in collaboration with everybody's favorite brewcaster, Tasty McDole. And then the beer, of course, named after Tasty. It's a 6.8% ABV with 58 IBUs. Sully likes to say it drinks easily, but isn't necessarily easy drinking.
That's right.
And then we couldn't get him to explain to us what that meant.
That's right. Well, halfway down the esophagus, barbs shoot out on either side and scrape.
Yeah. So. But it does have a mountain of hops in it. It's got...
Literally.
Calypso, Simcoe, Azaka, Amarillo, Citra, Simcoe Lupulin Pellets, Centennial, Cascade, Equinot, Cascade Lupulin Powder, Mosaic, and then Azaka again. I don't know why twice, but again. So it's a regular hop salad right there, that Tasty IPA, and you can find it on the shelves now. You can look it in, look for it in six packs or 19.2 ounce cans. Which I'm also still confused about, that Sully won't clear up for me.
Yeah. They're great.
All right. So as I mentioned at the top of the show, we've got the great Dr. Charlie Bamforth back in our studio today. The not-so-retired Charlie Bamforth.
Yes, I've never been retiring.
You never? Yeah. Now, you were, so of course, anybody who doesn't know, Charlie, retired from the UC Davis Brewing Science Program. How long were you at UC Davis?
20 years.
Is that right?
Yeah, and before that, 21 years in the brewing industry in England.
In England?
Yeah.
Not at a university, but in the industry.
Well, I was associated then with Heriot Watt University in Scotland. These days, I'm associated with Nottingham University in England. But I was at a place called the Brewing Research Foundation, which was doing research on behalf of companies all over the world. Went to BRF International then. So it's BRF, BRFI. And then they took the F out of it, and pardon the expression.
Yeah,
and it became
as you do, you
and
know.
It became BRI. But I also had 8 years with Bass, the Bass Brewing Company.
Oh, that's right, with Bass. I forgot about that too.
Yeah, in person on trend.
Now, and remind me, Charlie, when you graduated college, you know, when you got your PhD, or I should say, maybe as you were getting it, did you know then that you were going into beer, or
no.
Did you stumble into it later?
Totally stumbled into it. Staggered into it.
So literally.
I did a PhD in biochemistry, studied enzymes, so then I went to do a postdoc in, so I was a PhD in Hull and a postdoc in Sheffield. And then after a year, you sort of start looking at the job pages, and they wanted an enzyme guy at the Brewing Research Foundation. So give us a job, I can do that.
Ah.
Because I've been drinking beer for a
sure
fair few years.
Yeah.
So bringing sort of the professional interest and the personal interest together, and the rest is history.
So even then, so if you didn't necessarily plan it that way, still your entire career from the moment you left university was in beer.
Well, apart from the postdoc, which was technically my first job for a couple of years, but yeah, in beer. But so I went in as an enzyme guy, and then sort of, you know, branched out to doing all sorts of things.
Okay.
I often tell the story about going to my first boss. I'd been there about a year, and I said, you know, I'm not sure I'm satisfied in my job. And he said, why is that, lad? And I said, well, I'm a biochemist. I could be curing cancer. He said, do people like beer? I said, yeah. And do they enjoy beer? I said, yeah. And do they want a good beer? Yeah. So you don't think it's important to ensure that they get a bloody good beer? I said, well, of course it's important. Well, so well, bugger off and get on with it.
Yeah.
So I buggered off and I got on with it. And here we are 41 years later.
So I really like that you're telling this story too, because I think about that sometimes, and you know that other people are out there doing like good in the world, and I'm like, what do I do? I just, you know, people just drink more because of me.
No, not necessarily drink more, as long as you drink well and properly and responsibly, of course.
Right.
But it brings joy to people.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like any. You know, you say, well, you're a Shakespearean actor. You bring joy to some people, not that many, but you bring joy to them. And, and you know, it doesn't make them any less important than, you know, people doing jobs that are ostensibly more important.
Sure.
So it's all part of life's rich tapestry. So sure, it's a great thing to be working on beer.
Yeah, I love this. Great. That's the pep talk I needed
right there. Go for it. Wherever you go for it, young man.
Yes.
Yes.
Now... I would also say, and I hope you'll forgive me for bringing up age at all, but I think that for a person coming out of university when you did, they're few and far between that have had a long career in beer, is I guess what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, well, you got to remember, I got my PhD when I was 24. I was research manager for Bass when I was 31. So
okay.
So I got certain early an early start, should we say?
You
but,
did, yeah.
But yeah, I've been in a long time.
Yeah, and, that's wonderful.
Yeah, it is, and some people say too long, but it's been good to me, and hopefully I've been good for it.
How do you think the UC Davis brewing program is doing since you've left?
Fantastically well.
Yeah?
Yeah, people keep saying, oh, tough act to follow, and the answer is ridiculous, you know. And I probably said that in this room before, that, you know, I think it was Charles de Gaulle who said the graveyard is full of indispensable people.
Yeah.
You know, and life goes on, and I've got a great successor. His name's Glenn Fox.
Okay.
Should have him on the show. He's an Aussie. From Brisbane.
Interesting.
His specialty is cereals, so he's a barley guy, really.
Okay.
So that's good, because UC Davis are developing new barley varieties, malting barley varieties.
Sure.
And of course, they've got a strong relationship to the craft malting industry in California and so on. So it's great. You know, life goes on.
Does UC Davis have something against hiring Americans? Because there's Dr. Lewis, there's Dr. Bamforth, now there's, what's his name again? Forgive me?
Glenn Fox. Dr. Glenn Fox.
Dr. Fox.
No, not really. It just happens that way.
You're just smarter, aren't you?
No, it just happens that way, okay. You know. And I don't know. You know, people say, the English accent sort of, you know, you sound smart.
Right.
Yeah, it's more educational. There's a more educational air about you.
Yeah, we just pronounce the words properly. But apart from that, everything's...
Sure.
You know, like water.
Did you...
Throw an extra U in there and you're fine. Yeah. Everything's all good.
Did you have any say in your successor?
I just got one vote. I mean, all the faculty got a vote.
I see.
So, obviously, what was my role? I've been around for a long time. I know the people across the world.
Sure.
So I encouraged a few people to apply, and some of them did. And the faculty voted for Glenn, and that's great. Mm-hmm. Glenn's a super guy.
Okay.
He rides bicycles, so he's great for Davis.
Sure, yeah.
I can't ride a bicycle, so I was completely the wrong person. But
you literally can't, like, balance.
I've never ridden a bicycle in my life.
Is that right?
Yeah, and I can't swim either. So.
Wow.
If you want to kill me, put me in a bike.
Put you in a bike in a pool.
Pool.
On an island.
And I'm dead. I'm gone. Yeah. But yeah.
Well, you were just too busy in with books.
Drinking.
Yeah, doing too many other things, you know.
Yeah, okay.
I don't want to go into the real story, but anyway.
Yeah, okay, that's fair. Did you party in college? Yeah. Were you ever a partier?
Yeah, people say to me, I shouldn't really say this, but I will. What's your favorite beer? And I say, I never answer that question. I'm going to upset people. So I'll tell you my least favorite, Newcastle Brown Ale.
Oh, okay. My.
And people say, well, why is that? And I say, because... If you've ever had one too many, and I had one too many one night, and it wasn't the chap I shared the room with thought I'd grown a beard.
Yeah.
Isn't that dreadful?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever told it so vividly before, but I parted.
Yeah.
I parted. But and so people say, oh, that's terrible. You know, you tell people to drink responsibly. And of course, yes, do, because, you know, it's important to drink responsibly. But, you know, I learned from my error.
Right. Well, and for guys like us, for people like us, forgive me, who like have a career in the alcohol industry, it's almost even more important to drink responsibly.
It's absolutely
critical. You can't get carried away.
No, and I don't think I've ever been in that situation ever since joining the industry, because it's so important that you actually convey the right messages. And I've been all over the world of brewing loads and loads of times. I've been to meetings internationally on every continent, pretty much every continent. I don't think I've ever seen a paralytic brewer at a meeting.
Yeah,
I just don't think you don't see that.
No, I think you're right. And in fact, I will say that, over the years, I've met a person or two who just didn't last in the industry due to that. You know?
Correct.
So you can kind of see that coming.
It used to be the case that when I first came over here and people were interviewing for jobs, some of the larger brewing companies, there were three requirements. The first is you had to be prepared to work outside California. You know, there's,
yeah.
There's vacancies in Newark, New Jersey.
Right.
You mustn't have had a DUI.
Yeah.
And you mustn't have anything interesting to detect coursing through your veins by a sample from a sample of hair.
Yeah.
And I've had people fail on two of those three. I don't think I ever had anybody fail all three. But,
yeah. Right.
Two of the three, but the least likely. To fail on was the DWI, DUI, whatever it's called.
Sure.
It's a no-no. It was an absolute no-no.
Yeah.
The big brewing companies wouldn't employ them.
Yep. No, I think you're right. Yeah, gone are the days when, like, Augie Bush and the kids were out just, you know, doing it themselves.
Yeah, heaven forbid having the wheels shot out in St. Louis. But anyway, that's... Okay. Moving on.
So you retired from UC Davis, going on a year now, a little
December more? December
2018. Yeah. Okay.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you.
And what was your next move?
Sierra Nevada. So Ken Grossman, who I've known since I arrived here and is a good friend, he said, Charlie, come and join us. And I said, Ken, I want to retire. And then he looked at me and I thought, you know, all the wonderful things he'd done for UC Davis, as well as for the industry.
Yeah.
And I thought, I can't turn this guy down.
Right.
And he said, you can do as much as you, or as little as you want. Mm. I said, well, I'm not going full time. And I don't think an hour a week would be sufficient. So basically, I have a title, which is Senior Quality Advisor.
Okay.
So I'm contracted to Sierra Nevada. And basically... It works out a lot of time in my office at home, but I go to Chico about once a week. I'll be going up tomorrow.
Okay.
And the brief is, Ken's exact words were, Charlie, tell me what I need to hear, not what you want me to hear.
Yeah.
What I need to hear. And that's a great attitude, you know.
Huh. What does that mean?
I think he's such a legend. He's such a legend that people don't want to challenge him. They're scared of saying, actually, could we do this differently? And he wants people to do that. He wants people to, you know, and it's healthy, I think, that there are people who will say, hey, you know, there is another way of thinking. But he's such a legend, and I've said this so many times that it really is true that I as we've said, I've been in the industry 41 years, and he's legs, head and shoulders above everybody.
Yeah,
I mean, he's an astonishing chap. Whether it's business skills or environmental responsibility or people skills or the technicalities of it, there's nobody at Sierra Nevada knows more about what goes on in the breweries than Ken.
Than Ken, yeah.
It's absolutely astonishing.
Yeah.
So I'm just honored to be part of it.
He's a great company, a great guy. I've only recently started to get to know him a little bit. He's just a joy to be around also.
He is.
So he wanted help. It makes sense. You know, no one wants to be surrounded by yes men, as they say. You know, you need somebody who will be honest with you.
Yes, that's right.
And so
100%. That's very insightful.
Thank you, JP. And nobody but me. I just wants to be. So the idea, though, is you are going in there and tasting beer for Ken and helping him with quality control.
Well, it's rather more than tasting. Probably tasting is the least of my activities there.
Okay.
But really looking
analyzing.
Looking at the systems, looking at the way they do things, looking at... part of it is training as well, looking at the people, looking at their skills base, looking at how we might sort of advance them, develop them some more.
Yeah.
And really a jack of all trades. A lot of communication. I have a regular blog on the internal website there, where I sort of their equivalent of the internal Facebook, where I put out messages about quality and so on. So just generally, you know, championing the cause and doing all I can to bring my experience and wisdom to bear. So
sure.
So you're sort of like a talent scout in some ways too, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Right? Like who's good for promotion, who's good in this area we can.
Yeah, looking at the systems, what they've got, you know, what they might considerably try to do differently or could do differently and those sorts of things. But it's like I said to him, you know, I can't imagine that I'll find anything drastically wrong.
Well, and so that was a question I had for you, you know, without, you know, with taking privacy into, you know, concern. Is there anything that you could talk about that, you know, hey, we did find some areas to make a shift, you know?
No. Yes, there are things that I've suggested, and we won't go into them because, you know.
Fair. Okay.
But nothing earth-shattering.
Sure. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I mean, there's nothing of the sort that you say.
But that's...
I can't believe you're doing this. You know?
Yeah, okay.
I mean,
all right,
there's
yeah.
absolutely nothing like that. You know?
Yeah, you're picking nits.
I'm not surprised to hear it, not just because the beer is always so exceptional, but from what I've heard about Ken in general, that he's never really just rested on his laurels. He's constantly trying to improve. So it doesn't surprise me that maybe there wasn't something drastic, but that there were probably several areas to just continue to tweak and strive and...
Yeah. He wants the best.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... I'd say to people say, what book should I read? I say, well, just put Bamforth in Amazon. You know, there's a wide selection there. But really, seriously, read Ken Grossman, Beyond the Pale.
Yeah.
Because that is the most informative book that anybody who wants to be in craft brewing should read.
Yeah.
And the challenges of getting there. And you've only got to read that to realize that the guy's absolute commitment to doing it right.
Right.
I mean, it's legendary that the first beer he brewed, which actually was stout, he poured the first six batches down the drain because he wasn't happy with them and he didn't feel that it was of the quality or the consistency that, that he could put his name to.
Yeah.
I mean, how many people do that? I mean, it's and that attitude...
Not enough.
That yeah. attitude continues to this day, so it's got to be the absolute best. And the other story that's legendary, and probably Ken's tired of hearing me say it, but the very first words he ever said to me was, Charlie, what do you think of electron spin resonance spectroscopy? I mean, so 20 years ago, I said, Ken, I can't spell it. You know, I sure as hell wouldn't buy it. And
wow.
Of course he did.
Yeah.
Because he wanted to make sure that every tool that was at his disposal to improve and get the best quality was
yeah.
in place.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if you've been on your tour or your grand, you know.
Yeah.
They used to do that in England, you know, back in the day, the grand tour.
Yeah.
I trust you're going to Mills River.
It'll be my first time, and it is on the list. Yeah,
yeah, and absolutely. I mean, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, as you drive through the woods and drive through the forest, and there it is.
Wow.
I mean, it's astonishing, and that is a jewel.
Yeah.
It's a jewel. And I've been all over the world, and I've not seen anything to compare with it.
Yeah.
And
I've heard that.
That says it all. You know, it really says everything.
Yeah. And and this far into it, even at the, you know, I remember maybe to JP or somebody when we were up at the Chico Brewery, we're in the restaurant, you know, and I looked up and the air ducts, the air conditioning, HVAC ducts are copper. And I was like, okay, that's really like, that's when you just, you know, you sit down with your foreman, your contractor or whatever, and he gives you your options, and you just go, oh, just give me the most expensive shiny one that that's good enough for my brewery, and you have copper ducting.
It struck me as almost like, I haven't been yet, but my friend goes to Whiskeys of the World, like a big, you know, whiskey thing, like in San Francisco, big showcase, and, you know, try all the stuff. And the way you get the really good stuff is you go to the people and you start talking like you know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And then they look around and then they bring up a bottle from behind and they go, well, this is, you know, they don't have, so every like Macallan or whatever has all their wares up top.
Okay.
But they have special stuff for people who actually
know.
Right. That's what I think it was like. It's almost like Kim's like, what do you have?
Well, we
have the stainless and we have the, no. What do you have?
Right. And I've heard that he in this sense spared no expense, you know, for the brewing side of things in Mills River too.
I remember years ago I took a representatives of a very, very large brewing company just to look at it, to show them how things were done.
Yeah.
And we flew back in the company plane afterwards. and they said it's very good.
Yeah.
Well, we couldn't do that. And I said, why couldn't you do it? Because we're answerable to shareholders.
Yeah.
And the return on investment, it just wouldn't make sense to invest all that money. But of course, it's a family business, and they just believe in doing it right.
Yeah.
I think going public sort of ruins the trajectory of a business, or it can.
At least
sometimes, especially in stuff like this, or like Disney. they're public, they're beholden to shareholders, so everything gets price raised every year. They get there's ticket prices, and people are mad or whatever. But you could never do that as a brewery.
Yeah.
Imagine a brewery raising their prices two times a year, three times a year.
Sure.
It wouldn't be possible.
Yeah.
I mean, they make good decisions. Yeah. They do make good decisions, but they make decisions that is best for the family.
Yeah.
And by the family, I mean the company.
Yeah.
Not just Ken, not just the Grossmans, Katie, yeah. and the kids, the whole of the Sierra Nevada cause and the Sierra Nevada name.
Yeah.
Does that fit with the Sierra Nevada way of doing things?
Sure.
That's the fundamental decision. And I know things that some of the practices that I was used to in the British brewing industry, good practices, but relatively. What's the word I'm looking for? Accelerating.
Yeah.
And I know no way could I ever suggest some of those things to Ken. He just wouldn't want that.
Yeah.
So there's a certain traditional way of doing things.
That makes sense.
And I don't think that, and why should it change? Because
it works.
Yeah.
It clearly has worked. I was talking to, I think it was Vinny up at Russian River, and he made a comment about this very thing, about Ken's dedication to quality,
right,
and how it's always been. And he was talking about other brewers, talking about new brewers. Mm-hmm. And Vinny, forgive me because I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but something essentially Vinny was giving advice to some new brewers about something that they could change on the quality side.
Right.
You know, maybe it was about TPO or dissolved oxygen or something.
Right.
And the brewers, the answer was something to the effect of, well, you know, Vin, we already sell every drop of beer that we make, so you know, why do I need to spend this extra thing? And I believe Vinny's answer was, you know, if Ken Grossman felt that way, we wouldn't have the Sierra Nevada that we know today. Do you think that he wasn't always selling every drop of beer he makes?
Right.
He was. He always was, and he still was constantly improving.
Right.
And that's the attitude that Vinny took on after learning from Ken.
Totally.
You know, that it's not enough that you're selling all your beer. That's not enough.
No. It's got to be, everything's got to be right. I took a party of students to a brewery in the south of England about 3 or 4 years ago. And I stood at the bottom with the students of a cylindrical conical vessel. And there was mold on the cone at the bottom. There's mold on the outside. And I just looked at it. I was looking at it. And all the students were looking, smiling, and they're looking, what's he going to say? What's he going to say?
Yeah.
And this guy said, it's clean on the inside. I said, you know, the blessed Ken Grossman would weep to see that.
Yeah.
Because it's all wrong. Because that's just giving all the wrong messages.
Right.
You know, it's got to look right as well as be right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Standards, it's absolutely critical.
It's great that he takes it so seriously because the craft industry needs examples like that.
Oh, he's an absolute champion. But he's a champion for beer generally.
Sure.
It's a delight to be there.
So you're going there tomorrow. Give me an idea. What's a typical day for you when you go to the brewery?
Well, I have a couple of meetings tomorrow. So I'll meet with somebody who's on the training side because I've got various suggestions and ideas of things I'll do in 2020 on the training.
Okay.
Particularly at the more advanced levels and so on. And then we have a meeting on one of the products and my suggestions for how to, what are the newer products, my suggestions and involvement in how to ensure that it's the right product and looks and tastes right. And
sure.
And so,
go ahead and feel free to practice now and tell us what you're going to tell them.
So that's my tomorrow.
So you don't go spend time in the lab. That might not be a regular thing.
No, you won't find me with the white coat on because I'm, you know, these hands don't work anymore. You know,
got it.
The intellect is vast, but the brain is willing, but I don't know what the saying is. Anyway,
I get it. Yeah.
No, I've never been very good in the lab.
Okay.
I've always been more of an ideas guy. Yeah. When I was a young student and I was doing microbiology, they used to run guided tours past where I was doing this, you know, the aseptic work, just to show how it was done wrongly.
Wow. Yeah.
And how to improve.
Follow Dr. Bamforth.
Yeah. That's probably why it didn't work so well. There was just all these people coming by.
Yeah. Like a freak
disturbing,
show.
Disturbing the sanitary nature of your
I've always been more of an intellect than I have a practical practical hands-on. So no, I won't be.
Sneezing?
Did you make it part of your contract that every time you have to go to Mills River, the private jet is at your disposal?
No. Ken was very good the first time we actually, my wife, it was my wife's birthday, so she came along as well.
Wonderful.
You know, it was just great. I mean, you take your car, you park it in the hangar at Chico, you get on the plane, you put down to refuel, and then you arrive at Asheville, and Ken says, there's the car for you.
Wonderful.
And, nice. And it's hard to do United after that. But, you know, there's nothing on the plane that would tell you.
Yeah.
Whose plane it was.
Oh, yeah. Really?
You know, the colors are there, but
yeah,
it's all very understated.
Sure, he's not a very flashy guy.
He is not. Yeah. You know, he does things because it's the right thing to do, but he is. And, you know, all of the stuff he's done over for the local community in recent times speaks to the fact that he genuinely, and the family, they genuinely want to do the best.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm glad you got that gig. That's a good.
It is
it's
nice.
Good for you.
I'm honored. So at least one more year. So
okay. Yeah. And are you writing still?
I am writing. So there's a book about to appear. It'll appear in March, called In Praise of Beer.
Okay.
It's Oxford University Press, and that's really targeted at the beer drinker, not necessarily the expert beer drinker.
Okay.
But those who want to understand beer but are a bit intimidated by it. So you know. Messages on what to buy, how to buy, how to look after it, how beer's made, different styles of beer, the business of beer, why beer's healthy in moderation, all
wow.
those things.
I see.
Then there's the sixth in that. I do a series of the ASBC quality series. So there's been foam, flavor, freshness, color and clarity, and quality systems. And the last one's on safety and wholesomeness.
Okay.
And I'm also writing a soccer book.
Really?
And,
nice.
Because I've been writing about soccer for since 1985.
I remember you saying that. Yeah.
So I'm actually co-writing, I'm ghostwriting technically, the autobiography of a guy called Alan Hinton. Alan, if there's any listeners in Seattle, Alan is a legend thereabouts. He was the coach at the Seattle Sounders back in 1980.
Okay.
Later. And still ambassador for the club. He played for my team in England, Wolverhampton Wanderers. He was actually playing in the very first game I ever watched in 1962.
Really?
And then he went to Nottingham Forest, played with Derby County under Brian Clough when they won the championship, played for England.
Wow.
Then there was a tragedy in his life, terrible tragedy. But so he came over to Dallas and then Vancouver and where did he go then? Seattle. No, he went to Tulsa and then Seattle. And just an amazing guy.
And did you choose this project because you're such a fan?
What happened was he had another guy he was working with, this guy had to back out of it. So he contacted me and said, would you be interested in working with Alan Hinton on his autobiography? Which is a bit like saying, I don't know, you know, would you like to sort of...
Yeah.
I don't know.
Would you like to work with Ken Grossman?
Yeah.
Right.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Very much like that. And I said, yes, please. I'll do that.
Wonderful.
And so it's just amazing. We do most of it by Skype, but my wife Diane and I went up there just two or three weeks ago and spent time with Alan. It's magnificent.
Is that the first time you've met him?
Actually, first time I met him in person.
In person,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I write, I do a lot for a website called Wolves Heroes. So I've interviewed and met all sorts of players over the years.
I see.
And I've written one book before on beer.
Okay.
Not on football, soccer.
On football, okay, yeah.
Football, very good.
Yep.
This was about Wolverhampton Wanderers goalkeepers, so of course Alan was a left winger. I've interviewed lots of other players while I've been doing this, people he used to play with, and several of them have said he basically was the best crosser of a ball ever.
Jeez.
Better than Beckham.
Okay.
Wow. In fact, I wanted to call it better than Beckham, but, you know, you know all about it. I don't want to get sued, you know.
Yeah.
It's no fun getting sued.
It's not fun.
So we ain't going to call it that.
Now, so this having been your first time meeting him in person, did you fanboy? Did you gush? Were you nervous?
Did you cry? Did you weep?
I was nervous before I got there, but he quickly put my ease.
Wonderful.
So he's just a very natural guy.
Okay.
And he is a legend in Seattle. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
Everybody calls him Coach, no matter where you go.
Wherever he is.
Hi, Coach. How are you doing, Coach?
Oh, that's
and, of course,
wonderful.
The wonderful timing is that they just won the MLS Cup. So, I met up with the current coach, Brian Schmetzer, and I said, you know what I was doing while I was watching the game on TV? I was doing the ironing. My wife was in England, so and she was about to get back, so I was doing the ironing, you know? And so I watched this Seattle Sounders game, and before I knew it, I was in the celebration event in Seattle a couple of weeks later.
Wow!
Fantastic!
Which was just very special.
That's
very
great. Very special. You're a lucky guy, Dr. Bamforth.
Yeah. Dr. Charlie, Dr. Bamforth.
You know, I feel like, I mean, well, I think good things happen to good people, but I feel I sense from you that you feel grateful for the careers that you've had as well.
Totally. I mean, absolutely, very grateful and thankful to a lot of people. You know, nobody does things without having a lot of support and help. And there are people at various times in my career that nudged me in the right direction, including the guy who told me stop being a silly bugger and get on with it.
Get on with it, yeah.
But, you know, the guy who took me to Bass and the guy who took me to Harriet Watt and sure. All the other things as well. And my wife, I mean, absolutely amazing support from Diane, Charles and Diane from England. You know.
Yeah, of course, yeah. Yeah. Of course. In praise of beer, when can people expect
March.
This?
I believe it's coming out in March. You can pre-order it on the usual places.
Okay, probably Amazon and whatnot.
Yeah, one or two nice comments. I've seen that have, you know, in advance copies.
Yeah. I must have missed the email where you asked me to write the foreword. Spam.
I'm disappointed because I told the publishers that I was coming here this week and they should send you something in advance, you know, and they haven't done that. So
Even get a signed copy.
But you know, the thing I'm hoping for is that this one, if they want it on a recorded version.
Yeah.
I hope they're going to ask me this time.
There we go.
Because I got two previous books and they're read by somebody with a very pronounced American accent.
No.
And I'm thinking, no.
You're talking about beer. You have to have the educational accent.
Ooh. And Charlie has a great radio voice.
Yes. Oh, he totally does.
They don't know what they're missing, I think.
A little gravelly. Yeah.
Yeah. No, you gotta read your own.
Did I tell you that? I used to grade the examinations in England for a while, 10 years actually, and I'd never met the woman in the office before. And I used to phone her up and say, you know, the results will be with you very, very soon. Eventually I met her and she said, do you know something? I said, what? She said, you're better looking over the telephone.
Yeah, the face for radio.
Right. And my wife said, yeah.
Yeah, that's how she met you as well?
Yeah, and she's my biggest critic.
Oh, no.
I was with my good friend Terrence Sullivan. We're doing a lot of filming, actually, with Terrence for the 40th anniversary next year.
Oh, yeah.
So Terrence and I are busy recording certain snippets and so on at the moment, which is great.
Cool.
But years ago, Terrence and I were doing a thing in Sacramento Beer Week, and a lot of the women from Sierra Nevada were there, and I was talking as well. And halfway through, this woman with a very low-cut dress came along, and she draped herself all over me.
Wow.
And she said, could I have your autograph, please?
Wow.
I said, yeah, sure. And so she bent over, and I gave her the and she said, do you know something? I said, what? She said, you're seriously cute.
Ah.
And seriously cute.
Seriously cute. Damn. And then she disappeared. And all these women from Sierra Nevada were, oh, that's awful. And Diane smiled and said, she's drunk.
Oh, oh no.
Says it all, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't have any false understanding of anything like that.
I feel like in your career, you've done so much. You need someone to ground you.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, she does that.
She's your anchor.
While we're on the subject of saying what I've been doing as well, there's another thing coming out early in the new year.
Okay.
And that is one of these great courses. I don't know if you ever see them advertised in the newspaper. You know, they have, you know, all about the Bible and about art and about all these different things, literature and so on.
Yeah.
Well, the beer one, we just recorded that.
So we did
half of it in the studios in Virginia, but the other half at Mills River.
Okay.
And so apart from me, there's lots of good people on there. Brian Grossman's talking on there. Scott Jennings, Liz Huber, the quality manager. And we did a beer dinner with Jessie. She's a cordon bleu chef. She runs the restaurant at Mills River. So we're doing the 5-course beer pairing dinner and so on and so forth.
Wow.
So that will be coming out, I think, also in March.
What is that called?
Well, Great Courses.
Okay.
I think it's Everything You Need to Know About Beer or something like that. I think it's called.
Got it.
But it'll be advertised in the, you know, the newspapers. They always advertise, you know, $399 reduced to $66, you know, whatever.
Of course, yeah. But, and if you buy now.
Yeah. And we'll give you two.
Yeah. Yeah. What do I need two for? Doesn't matter.
So that'll be coming out as well. So, yeah.
Wonderful.
I've been busy.
You are keeping very busy. Mm. I feel like you should relax a little bit, maybe.
Well, I'm relaxed as well.
You don't golf or anything?
Why?
Do you have a hobby besides writing about soccer? I mean, I know that's not even, that's a profession, but I feel like that for you,
that's my relaxation.
Yeah.
I do a bit of babysitting, though, not as much as my wife does. But,
okay, yeah.
No, I don't golf, I don't fish.
Are you available to hire for babysitting? Because
no.
I would love to have...
Okay. No.
Absolutely not, yeah.
No,
yeah.
Four is ample.
Right.
But, no, that's... soccer is my relaxation.
Okay.
So, yeah, it takes me away from the...
Okay.
The beer.
So, what would you say, you know, you used to get to do this every day with your students.
Right.
You know, what's your sense about craft beer now? If you had a couple of your students in front of you and they told you, Dr. Bamforth, I want to open a brewery one day too, a craft brewery. What would you say to them right now?
Laughter.
Well, first of all, I'd say, will you stop calling me Dr. Bamforth? Please
call me. Your students called you Dr. Bamforth,
no,
didn't
they? No, I refuse.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I know there are some educators that insisted on it, but I didn't.
I see. Okay.
I said, don't call me Mr. Bamforth. That really pisses me off.
Yeah, at least get
but
it right.
Call me
yeah.
Charlie, but, you know, but yeah. So I would say, first of all, what's the business model?
Mm-hmm.
Are you brewing enough to make a living? Have you got an outlet for it?
Yeah.
Is there someone to sell the beer? Have you got a good structure? The second thing is quality is everything.
Mm-hmm.
So make sure you understand that people want quality.
And we know it now, too. We're educated. The consumer is smart enough now to know the difference.
Yeah. And then I would have difficulties because I'm torn between what I see is happening and what is doing well.
Okay.
And what personally feels comfortable.
Okay.
Inside, for example, there's many people these days going into the sort of the alcoholic seltzers and all these things.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan.
You think that's a passing trend, or
I hope so.
Yeah. Okay.
And you got to remember that back in the day when I was at Bass, we were responsible. I was responsible for new product development, so I had a team working for me. And we made these flavored alcoholic drinks.
Okay.
And so I've been there, I've done it. We came out with one of the first. It's called Hooper's Hooch.
Hmm.
Let's not kid ourselves. They were targeted at young people.
Yeah.
And it never sat then and doesn't now very comfortably with me.
I see.
Equally, I'm not a big fan of different recreational items coming together in the same glass.
Mm-hmm. Which is going to happen.
Yeah, because that doesn't make it twice as sinful. It makes it four times as a challenge to people. And I would also, I've urged people to sort of celebrate malt, hops, yeast, and water. You know, I think there's still a lot of mileage there. I have no difficulty with using sensible materials that are time-honored, but I'm not a big fan of bizarre and wacky components.
Sure.
But, you know, I said such a thing in London a couple of years ago, and I was described as a Luddite.
Oh, no.
You're a complete Luddite.
Wow.
So, you know, I would not have predicted, and I was a bit critical early on, as I think some other people are, of hazy beers.
Yeah.
These days, I just keep my eyes shut.
Because
some of the flavors are great.
I agree with you.
And so hazy beer on a scale the scale of total acceptance through to total rejection.
Yeah.
Hazy beers would be nowhere near total rejection, but they wouldn't be they're not total acceptance to me.
I understand.
But I can't. I've looked at the numbers and I've seen what is selling and what is doing well. And who would I be to challenge that?
Sure.
So, but equally, I know that alcoholic seltzers are doing very well. That to me is not beer.
Yeah.
Even though it's there for tax reasons of beer, it's not beer to me. And therefore, if I had my way, I'd tax them through the roof.
and it sounds like maybe you worry that that marketing to a younger crowd is morally suspect.
I'm not a fan of it. I think that it's responsibility is very important. I told you what I said about Newcastle Brown earlier on, and you know, confession times and so on. We've all been there. We've done something like that.
Yeah.
But to actually overtly go out and position products at what I might describe as a less mature audience.
Yeah.
I think is not healthy. Healthy, and using the word healthy to position them as a healthier option to beer.
Yeah, right. I think I have a big problem with that too.
It is really a bad thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's low calorie. I mean, come on, guys. Low calorie means healthy.
Right.
It's taking... the only scale that we have for health is calories.
Right.
Well, and it's kind of bullshit anyway that it's really low calorie.
Whoa,
like,
Teresa.
Almost all the calories in an alcoholic beverage come from the alcohol. Yeah. So,
yeah, they can do the low carb thing, but the low calorie thing is a little suspect.
I have a low carb story from a guy from Anheuser-Busch contacted me. He said, have you read the South Beach Diet? I said, no. He said, you need to read more. And he said, it says beer is the worst thing you can put inside you because it's got the worst carbohydrate of all, maltose.
Okay.
So I wrote to Dr. Agatson. I said, have you ever heard of fermentation? Because the maltose is converting to alcohol. Yeah, alcohol is the main source of calories, but it ain't maltose.
Right.
So they then said, due to recent research, we can rescind the ban on beer. You know?
Reason.
And what did AB do in the interim? They brought out Michelob Ultra.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And marketed it as low carb. And I said, that's dumb. You market something as low carb, that means everything else presumably is high carb.
Right.
Irrespective of whether it is or it isn't.
Yeah. It's marketing.
It is. Yeah. And I had the problem years ago in Bass, you know, suggested you come out with organic beer. And they say, one of your dumber ideas, Charlie, because if you say this is organic, somehow better, what about the rest of our products? Are they not as good?
Yeah.
So,
and that Sam Smith has a whole line of organic beers, and they seem to be doing pretty well.
Sam Smith, yeah. The only brewery I've ever been denied access to.
Oh,
really?
They won't let anybody in there.
Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know what they're trying to hide.
Yeah, that worries me.
I don't know what they're trying to hide, but they're very secretive.
Okay.
They're very, very secretive.
I love that brewer. I have so many memories of that brewer, just drinking that nut brown.
The nut brown,
and oatmeal stout. And thank God, can we just go on a tangent real fast, that they don't have clear bottles anymore, that their beers are now in brown bottles. Because I can buy
them. I didn't even know
again.
They were still around.
Oh, my goodness.
They used to be in clear bottles?
Yes.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, it was a very Russian roulette kind of time where you go, well, because going to BevMo and you're 25 and you don't know any better. You're like, oh, this is not good.
Yeah.
But the next one might be good.
Yeah.
So,
you know, our friend Dan Gordon used to make a light beer. Not because he wanted to. I think at the time his partners or something sort of forced him to. Yeah. And I remember asking him once. I was like, what do you do to make a light beer? And he goes, I just add water, man. He literally just dilute. He's like, I make a Pilsner. And then I add water, and I end up with a low. You know, it just dilutes it. And it was just my favorite simple. And he was saying, basically, he was saying, look, in other words, don't buy into all that bullshit. Just you know what? Have a handful less chips while you drink your beer, and you're probably going to be okay. Yeah. You know, less junk food while you're drinking.
Yeah, and that's the main part of it.
Yeah,
beer drinker versus wine drinker. Wine drinker eats lettuce leaves. Beer drinker eats birds.
I was having a glass of Chardonnay the other night, and I ran out of lettuce.
Right.
It was a bad night.
Yeah.
Now, will we in any time in the near future, maybe even, let's call it my lifetime, will we see another Sierra Nevada or a New Belgium? Will we see another large regional craft brewer that can make it to that size without, being bought, for example?
In the next 5 years, no.
You know, my life, yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I don't know. Crooked Lane, that'd be a great.
I know. I'm really working on it.
Teresa. It seems unlikely to me.
It seems unlikely to me.
Let's be honest. I mean Crooked Lane.
That timing was amazing. I was back here by myself, and I was like, "Oh, damn."
Dick move.
Yeah.
I don't know. It really does need a special set of circumstances, you know.
Yeah.
And of course, Ken was a pioneer at the time when you couldn't buy a brewery from a catalog. On that scale, he had to make his own.
Yeah.
So everything was done in a different way. So, and then it just grew and grew and grew.
Mm-hmm.
So for somebody to start from scratch now and get to that scale without either merging or acquiring or being acquired. So I can't think how it's going to happen. But I do want to tell you that I consider Teresa one of my success stories. She came on one of my 1 week classes. So yeah. And I'd like to think I taught her all she knows.
I honestly will take it because, you know, we're all talking about fanboying.
Yeah. You can
fanboy.
So
I'm the biggest fangirl of this guy. I have this picture on my phone. I asked for one of my friends at the CCBA because...
Charlie's your home screen?
No. Well, he could be now.
Yeah.
So a few years ago at the summit, this is actually not the picture I was trying to get because there's one that's even better. But here I am in the front row.
Charlie's up on stage. Yeah.
Charlie's on stage. I'm like front and center, just laughing at every joke.
Oh, yeah, you are. You're like, oh, Charlie, you're so funny.
I actually heard Charlie speak before I ever worked in beer.
Really?
Yeah. So once upon a time, I worked in biotech, and I was at the ASMS.
Oh, yeah.
You spoke at American Society of Mass Spectrometrists.
There's a society.
That sounds fun.
So the little company I work for had a booth there, so I was there. And I walk in, and he is the keynote speaker. And I showed up a little late, and I step in the door, and the topic is why beer is greater than wine.
All right. As it would be.
Yeah.
And I was like blown away.
Yeah.
So I'm the biggest fan.
Charlie. And you know that she's California Brewer of the Year.
I do know that.
Yeah.
And I'm taking all the credit.
Yeah, as you should.
Yeah. Congratulations, Charlie, for her win.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Don't give me the thing. I'll lose it, though.
Yeah. So that's a great photo, though. Charlie speaking to the crowd, and you're right there, right up
front.
I know.
I am. Every time he speaks, I sit in the front, and I'm like,
I must have showered.
Let the wisdom fall.
No, it's more like spittle that's been showering all over you.
It's a little awkward, honestly. But I'm a huge fan of you. I really appreciate all you've done for craft beer and craft brewers. And I don't know.
I was up in Portland once. I was getting a flight home. It was 5:30 in the morning. And I could sense somebody's eyes on me.
Yeah.
And I looked at this guy looking at me. And he stood up and he said, "It is, isn't it?" I said, "Who?" He said, "Pope of Foam." Charlie Bamforth. I said, "Yeah." He said, "Where are you going?" I said, "Home." Get over it.
Perfect response.
Oh, man.
What was it you were talking? What's the word you were looking at? You were fawning around people. Anyway, there you go.
He fanboyed.
Yeah, over you.
Yeah, the Pope of Foam. He went that far. Something like that.
But it backfires sometimes.
Yeah.
I got a message to an email. I'd written something about casks in England. Sometimes on the back of the bar, you know, so actually sitting there just you know, tapped on the back of the bar. And this guy challenged it. Mm. And there was an exchange of emails. And he was getting increasingly irate. And then finally his last email said, "Well, actually, I've never heard of you."
Oh, wow. See, I like when it goes that way.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks. That's great.
Sometimes listeners will fuck with me and they'll see me like at the Great American Beer Festival.
Yeah, yeah.
And they'll go, hey, can we take a picture? And I go, "Yeah." And then they hand me their phone to take a picture of them with their girlfriend or something, or their wife. And I'm like, "Oh, you fuckers."
I've been in wedding albums. I remember a Japanese guy, he was on his honeymoon.
Really?
And he said, "My wife would like a photograph of you and me together for our album." You
know? Wow.
So, I mean, this guy's wedding album.
Yeah. You never met.
Bizarre.
Wow.
His wife too kept.
See, now, if you were working in research in some kind of...
Yeah.
Nuclear
physics
capacity. Nobody is going to want their picture taken with you.
Right.
No.
Yeah. So even, you know, Jamil Zainashev.
Yes, vaguely. I know the guy.
You know Jamil.
Yeah.
He is famous in the programming world. He worked for Adobe, actually, before it was Adobe. He worked for some other. Anyhow, he was telling me that he would get flown to these conferences around the world, and he, because he's pretty famous now through the Brewing Network and stuff,
right.
At the beer stuff. He was like, it's nothing compared to these tech conferences I would go to.
Really?
He had this weird, like, famous, he was a famous programmer.
Huh.
But you, I'm saying that you're right. Other than in these little, like, you know, niche things, if you're good at anything else, no one ever knows your name.
Right.
But there's something about beer. Oh, it's so democratic or something that it just, you know, people become fans.
I think it's more approachable. It's very much more blue collar than obviously... programming, but another thing Jamil's famous for is he developed some sort of like a trigger or some mechanism in paintball guns.
Oh, that's right.
To fire semi-automatic, and the company he developed them for gave him like a gold-plated. This is a story I heard from Chris Graham.
Yeah,
a gold-plated paintball gun.
Paintball gun, yeah.
Because of that, so this cat has done numerous shit. That's
it's
very
true.
Weird.
Every field he goes into, he
does a very good job. Yeah, and I think it partially is he like we're talking about Ken Grossman. He's very focused on the quality.
He cares,
he's
going
to do it. He's going to do it right. He'll experiment and have fun, but if it's released to the public, it has to be on point. But I think with beer, it's very approachable, and for the reason Charlie is so famous and people bond with him instantly, is because he brings the knowledge to an approachable level.
Yep.
Where even dummies like you and me,
we get it,
or smart people like Teresa, we can all understand it. We can all feel like we're equal.
It's true.
Yeah.
That's why we keep inviting Charlie back, because he makes us feel less dumb about ourselves.
Yeah. He's our own Tony Robbins.
Yeah,
I'm just really hopeful he'll start a like fourth career in stand-up comedy or something.
Yes,
I think that could be a successful avenue.
I've been roasted in at the comedy club in Sacramento. I go in there and they say, Charlie, actually, you keep it straight. We're the guys who are going to be funny.
Yeah.
So please.
You keep it straight.
Just dumb it down.
No.
Yeah. Of course not.
Nah.
You know what I think you need, Charlie,
is
a
wig?
A podcast.
Oh, a podcast.
Oh, for sure.
You know, probably on the Brewing Network, for example. I feel like you need your own show to round out your illustrious career.
Yes, maybe.
When you're done at Sierra Nevada, you call me. We'll talk. I pay nothing, and you work really hard. Sound good so
far? Well, I'm used to working hard, and I was in university, so I didn't really do it for the money.
Exactly. Great. We're a perfect fit.
Money, I was paid well at Bass, but there you go. I gave all that up to
a long time ago.
To go and edumacate.
Yes.
Or as my wife's father used to say, I was educated to the height of ignorance.
Perfect.
Wow.
Perfect.
That's the great thing about people in England. You keep your feet on the ground, you know?
Yeah.
You have to.
Yeah, I remember an uncle of mine said... well, you're still at school then. When are you going to do a proper job, you know?
Wow.
And I was at a family wedding once, and I heard one of my aunts say, actually, it was a funeral.
same thing.
Yeah.
Happy, happy kid. Anyway, she said, that's Charles, you know, Charles, my nephew. He's a professor. We've never had one of those in the family before.
absolutely. Is your wife retired?
She's been retired basically since she arrived here.
No,
she was a trained nurse in England or a health visitor, but that's a long thing to explain what they are.
Okay.
So she never actually practiced as a nurse here, but she did do a lot of work for non-profits. And she's a volunteer. She's a professional volunteer. So,
okay.
She's the person who does all the good work. She's done a lot for a lot of people.
But then I guess I'm just asking too, because she makes sure that you get out of the house and keep busy.
So, but she's on my case.
Yeah. does she not, in all seriousness, does she not think, hey, Charlie, do you want to slow down a little and relax? Does she ever say that?
She's not said it recently.
Okay.
But she, as I say, I think I'm going to have to start losing a bit of weight soon. And,
okay.
She keeps using words like personal trainer.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
You can't go full stop with that. You got to baby steps, Charlie.
Yeah.
Baby steps. No personal trainer.
No. So, so maybe she's actually trying to kill me off.
Oh, no.
No, I think she is. I think she's got... She thinks the balance is about right at the moment, I think.
Okay, all right.
But
We've
been married. How long have we been married now? Since 1976. So
is that right?
43 years.
Yeah, the year before I was born, you got married.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Hello, son.
I wish, Charlie. Yeah. It'd be great. Yeah. You imagine if you had a failure of a son like me, Charlie, after your illustrious career.
Yeah,
you need one black mark on your life, you know, and it would be me.
You would inherit textbooks.
And that's good. Yeah. Thanks, Dad.
Yeah, the thing you need the most.
I can't even read.
Yeah. You never taught me. You were never there.
You're always teaching other kids about beer.
Yeah. But not me about love.
You see, it's things like that, you see, it makes you feel really, really old, you know. Because you don't look young, do you, really?
Well, I know. Exactly.
I don't think he's looked young for 20 years.
I really haven't. I am a kind of a disaster myself, so yeah. I should make you feel young, frankly.
I must have told the story before going into the Gordon Beers place at San Francisco International Airport, and they carded me.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I said, how badly do you think I've lived, for God's sake?
Yeah, exactly. I'm definitely going on 60, obviously. Well, Charlie, it's wonderful, as always, to speak with you.
Always a pleasure to be here.
In praise of beer, you can buy it pre-sale now, and it's coming out in March.
Yep.
And then the TV show again, the episode?
The Great Courses.
Thank you.
Great Courses, so they'll start advertising that soon.
You can look for that.
It's the thing, they advertise them on the web, obviously, but also you get them in your... Every good newspaper will carry.
There we go.
An advertisement for that.
And the football book.
And the book that we're not sure when the publishing is going to be.
Okay.
We're dotting the I's, crossing the T's. So sometime that will go to the publisher in 2020.
Okay.
Hopefully earlier in 2020. And we're hoping it's going to be a big seller in the Midlands of England, but also obviously in Seattle and Vancouver and other places.
In celebration of Liverpool winning the cup. There we go, baby.
Wrong team, I'm afraid. But there we go. So,
and it's not called Better Than Beckham.
It's not going to be called Better Than Beckham. At the moment, the working title is Triumph and Tragedy.
Okay.
There was a terrible tragedy in Alan and Joey's life. But they came to America, and it's been a wonderful journey for them.
For them, sure.
It's actually going to be called Doing Better Than David is what it is.
Yes. Sounds like a good read, actually.
I'm thrilled with that. And Alan, I think Alan's thrilled with it, too. So it's,
good.
It's been a great experience.
Well, what more could you ask?
That's awesome.
Well, Charlie, I feel like you've done it all. You know, you've done it all.
No, I've never ridden a bike, but
except for swim and ride a bike.
Yeah. I happen to have a bike outside.
No.
And I used to teach adults how to swim. So let me know.
Wow.
The bike thing sounds like a phobia to me. I don't know if there's a word for bike phobia, but you have it. I can tell.
I think it's bike phobia.
Yeah.
Something like that, or four-wheel filia.
Okay. Right. All right, folks. Charlie, the great Charlie Bamforth.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Of course, you're welcome back anytime. And what I would like to do, I will exchange email afterward, because I'd like to book the new professor at UC Davis on, as you suggested, too.
Absolutely.
I think that'd be fun to talk to him.
Hey, well, he's got an Aussie accent, but so if you need me as well, I'll do the translation.
I will need a translator. Yeah, that one's even worse, that accent.
Just don't talk about cricket. That's
okay. I'll leave that alone. All right, folks, we are going to take ourselves a quick break. And when we come back, I believe we've got a couple special visitors to hang out with us for our last show of 2019.
This is a surprise.
Of the decade.
Last show of the decade. Interesting. All right, hang in there. It's the session. We'll be right back.
I'm not. Hey, motherfuckers, this is Doug from fucking Society. You're listening to The Session on the fucking Brewing Network. Fuck you.
Thanks, Dougie. Hey, welcome back to the show. I'll turn my own microphone on now.
Blame Dougie. His poor language there. We miss you, Dougie.
I've had two of Society Harlot tonight, so that's probably the
problem. So good.
Yeah. And I just switched to Pliny because I'm glutton for punishment or something. I don't know why.
Just ratchet it up another notch.
Yeah,
why not?
Not that it's not a wonderful beer. I'm just ratcheting up. Exactly.
It's a holiday season. Go for 8%.
So a little surprise for you all. You know, a listener had written in not too long ago, and they said, if I could ask for something for Christmas, it would be to bring back the crew and update us on what they're up to. So joining us in the studio right now, Nathan Smith is here. That's right.
Where did they unearth all these people?
That's right.
In the graveyard.
And lo and behold, Doc is also back in his chair.
Dr. Scott, everybody.
I'm glad you gave me my own chair.
You get your own chair back.
Yeah, it feels good.
Shimke's here.
Boo!
Is that thing working? Let's
cheers
see.
For Kim.
I don't know, is it?
Yeah, it is. I think so. Try again.
That's too bad.
Sorry. Yeah.
Oh, it's trying to work. It's really trying to work.
It would rather not work than be used by Kim.
Who sabotaged Kim's microphone?
Try again.
So
mean.
Actually, it could be anybody's guess.
Yeah.
I think it's working, kind
of. Yeah, it's sort of working.
We were using that one.
Oh, it's in and out.
I blame the person who did the wire.
Some things never change, right, Doc?
Yep, exactly.
All right,
being back in the garage
share
again.
With Pasuti, then. I'm not messing with that thing. Gotta rewire the whole goddamn thing.
Yeah.
And then I turn you off? No, yours, that's on. Okay. Is that on? Try it.
Are we on?
Yeah, there you go. Okay, I'll just have to crank it up. All right. Enough of that nonsense. Welcome back to the studio, gentlemen and lady.
We miss it.
Yeah.
It's great.
It's been a while since we've had you on the session, right? You've helped out with Hop and Brew School a little bit, Nate.
Yeah, that show's great. Thank you.
Yeah.
The attentive listeners will hear me from time to time on that show, but it's been a minute since I've been on this show.
That's right, yeah. Thanks for coming all the way out here.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you.
And Doc back in his own chair.
Yeah, feels good.
We need updates, but first I gotta take care of a sponsor real quick.
That warmth you feel in the seat? It's Charlie Bamforth warmth.
Yeah, I saw the back of his head.
Yeah, or
Charlie Bam warmth.
Yeah,
right?
Charlie Band warmth. Yeah.
We've had two doctors in that chair tonight.
Right. Yeah. There you go.
Wow.
How far have we come?
Passing up the plate.
What other website, what other podcast can say two doctors
None.
On the same show?
Not one.
Yeah. Neither of them can tell me if I'm having a heart attack.
Right. All right. Hey, real quick, don't forget about the wonderful Duke Cannon. That's right. This segment is sponsored by Duke Cannon Country, where eggnog is served spiked and without the eggnog.
Do you want to know a secret?
Yeah.
I have not used Duke Cannon soap since the last time we talked about it. That's how long since I've taken a shower.
I was going to say, because you haven't showered?
Because I haven't showered.
You haven't showered in a week.
I'm just kidding.
This is a point of...
I thought it'd be funny to say. No, I used it on Saturday, and it was very good.
No, we don't believe you. This is like a point of pride with you now, I think.
Well, you're in the best position to determine that, because we are...
I can give a sniff test.
Yeah, we might need a smell test. So I though, have gone the weekend without showering.
Smelling really fresh over here.
All weekend. Yeah. And my hope was to get home, throw a little Duke Cannon on the body wash, and come into the show, but I haven't. So now I'm looking forward to going home after the show and showering with my Duke Cannon. And right now they've got their limited edition U.S. military soap set, and that's the one where you get five bricks of the big-ass soap. It's called Big Ass Brick of Soap, but it has different scents, too. Like the military soap, one scent is called Victory. And you know what that smells like, don't you, Nate? You know, like how I looked away from JP when I got to the...
Smells like smoldering corpses. No, I'm just kidding.
Smells like face-melting licks, bro.
You get a Big Ass Brick of Naval Supremacy.
Is that for your belly button?
That's like an aqua... No. It's an aquamarine scent. You get a Big Ass Brick of Productivity.
Okay. Don't know what that smells like at
all. It's got a mint scent to it.
Okay, a little reviving, kind of energetic sort of a deal. Gotcha. Yep. All right.
The regular old big-ass beer soap is kind of a woodsy sandalwood beer.
That's
the one you took, right?
Well, no. I took the bourbon one, but I got... So when I ordered the... I forget what it's called now, but it's the Dobbs bag with that made from the Ladder 39. I think is the firefighter company I talked about on the last show. It's reused fire hoses and all that kind of stuff, right? I got a free bar of soap on the rope.
Oh,
and it was the beer soap made with Old Milwaukee, and it smells very good. Yeah. I actually, I'm thinking about keeping it, but I'm so cheap, I kind of want to regift it. So,
yeah, that's
it,
a good one.
It smells great.
And then you get the bourbon soap, which you have, which I really like. A little oak barrel with some woodsy smell.
It and honestly looks like I haven't used it. That's how big it is.
I know, yeah.
Though you can still see the impressions of the name. It's a whole thing.
Yeah, I have a brick in my shower now that I've been using for at least 3 weeks, and it's still a giant brick of soap. Yeah.
So when you prepare a drink to bring in the shower with you, you can bring like a beer to match the beer soap.
Basically,
or a bourbon to match the bourbon soap. Yeah. Come
a good
on.
Call.
Yeah.
Some pairing.
And Doc, you'll like this. All of this stuff that I've mentioned, it comes in an authentic military field box that used to carry 30 cal ammunition.
I like that.
So
keep your soap dry.
When they sent it to me, I got this military box, and I was like, "Uh-oh, what did I do? What happened?" but it was from Duke Cannon. It also comes with a free screwdriver, which is just amazing. So just go to DukeCannon.com and use promo code Brewing. And you're going to get 15% off the entire order. Plus, you get free shipping on anything over $35. Use coupon code BREWING and get yourself some Duke Cannon. Trust me. That's a great gift set, by the way. You know, you don't have to buy it for yourself. You can buy it for somebody else. All right. Well, Doc, what have you been doing? Where are you all right? Are you healthy? Are you divorced? Do you have a job? What's happening with Doc?
I'm still working, doing the same old doctory thing.
You're doctoring still?
Toothing? Toothing, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, not divorced yet.
Okay.
We're supposed to have a court date tomorrow.
Really?
But it got canceled or got postponed again.
Moved again?
Yeah.
How long this has been going on?
Four years. Yeah. I'm not happy about it.
No.
At all.
Wow. Have you gone to court at all?
Just once she took me to court she wanted more spousal support.
All the things.
And the judge wasn't kind to me. He was an asshole.
Oh no.
I got railroaded hard. And I couldn't say anything about it. And it's like, there's no proof of this or that. And so it's like,
so you just did what you had to do.
I got nothing to say about it. Yeah.
Okay. So all right. So you've been at least for that one. That didn't go well.
No.
And then you still have to go just to finalize everything?
No, we haven't even started bickering back and forth yet. It's just between the lawyers and the court appointed CPA lady and it's just dragging and dragging.
Well, did you go to Burning Man this year?
Yeah, it was my 20th year.
Oh, yeah.
Really?
2-0. Nice, Doc.
God bless.
Well, that was a good break from the norm then.
Yeah.
For out of here.
Yeah, definitely.
Did they build you a special man or anything? Did you know?
Were you the man this year?
Yeah, really.
You're like, just light me on fire, damn it.
I had a pretty good party.
Okay.
We do a night party now, a big glow party, and we're trying to make it the place to be on Tuesday night.
Okay.
Because, you know, they have different places where Sunday night you want to be, certain places.
You're trying to corner the Tuesday night.
Yeah,
market.
We've got it pretty big now.
Hell yeah.
We had, the family dinner kind of thing at the camp, and we're supposed to start the party about 9, face painting, glow painting, and all that stuff. And
yeah.
I got to take a nap because I've been up for a while, and I slept through most of the party. I got about 1.
When it's over.
Yeah, pretty much.
But you had a good year. You still had a good 20th burn.
Yeah, it was good.
When's the last time you brewed a beer, Doc?
Oof, it's been a while.
I saw your brewing equipment still out at your house there. It's there.
Yeah.
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 You just haven't had the time to brew yet?
Do you
brew on the Pico brew when you brew?
Yeah, I have lately. Mm-hmm. To do that one. I've been distilling more than...
Oh,
brewing,
is that right?
So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Theoretically.
In theory. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, and then.
What have you been making? Like absinthe and shit? Bourbon or what?
Absinthe. I'll probably be doing a bourbon here pretty soon.
Okay.
All right.
Where are you getting your wash if you're not brewing?
Do Pico Brew.
Oh, okay. So you just make a wort still.
Yeah. Or I'll use already fermented stuff to redistill.
Okay.
Very nice. Do you have like tiny barrels to do your bourbon in?
Yeah, about that big.
Yeah.
Wow.
For folks at home, that was about the size of a football.
Rugby ball. 2 liter or so.
You just buy those. You can buy those new, right?
Yeah.
At places like More Beer, for example.
Yep. Yeah. You have to
for a bourbon.
Yeah. Hmm. And it makes a world of difference because it tastes like old socks coming out of the still.
Wow.
Throw it on some American oak, see what it does.
Yeah. And it doesn't take long in a small barrel. That's like a big barrel.
Okay.
And so you get a good. Why is that? It's surface area. Surface area.
Yeah.
Why does it come out smelling like old socks? Is that an effect of distilling in general, or is that just like home distilling is like that?
No, it's all like that.
That's what he puts in.
It's all like that.
Yeah. it's just harsh, kind of like fire water kind of stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. That's why they call it white dog.
Yep.
Right?
The white lightning, white dog phase.
I see.
Yeah.
And it's just, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it just mellows it out, gets some caramel flavors and color into it in a little while. And
oxidation is a wonderful thing at some point.
Yeah. It just makes a whole different animal.
So it's surface area of the wood and oxidation too.
I think some
permeation
there a little bit.
Cool.
Yeah, it just makes a world of difference.
So you want oxygen to get there, not like to a
point, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, at a certain point for sure. Well, you can't help it with in the barrel, the micro oxidation.
Yeah.
Even the surface area, because it's not full to the top.
Okay.
Head space and, yeah.
It's not like beer where there's like going to be a protective pellicle or something.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Right.
No, you're not going to get any growth in there.
Yeah. Right?
It's not like beer or wine.
Nothing can live in there.
No.
Because that barrel strength, it's like, barrel strength is what, like 120 proof?
At least.
Yeah.
130.
So, yeah.
How do you know the proof of yours? Is there a way to test that?
You ask it, dummy.
Yeah, I have a proof hydrometer. It looks like a regular beer hydrometer, but it comes in percent alcohol and proof.
I see.
It's just basic. You know, gauge different.
Oh, okay. You just drop it on there.
Yeah.
Sight glass, like always.
Yep.
Okay, I see. All right. So, you know, because I ask, because you're like, you don't want to kill yourself. You don't want to end up with, like, you know, 200 proof. I don't know.
It's hard to get 200 proof.
Ever clear.
Yeah. It's hard to get 200 proof. You won't kill yourself unless you drink a ton of it.
Let's try.
You might go blind. Isn't that what it is? You go blind?
No. That's if you don't know what you're doing.
Yes,
yeah, so you got to get the methanol out of there first.
Right.
At least know what you're doing.
Okay.
Possible. Yeah. You can potentially go
blind. Yeah, yeah.
But isn't it like a permanent blindness too?
Yeah.
Yeah. Or not, no, it's, yeah, it's temporary
like,
is what
it's
I meant.
Like real
but
blindness.
Yeah. I meant temporary. I thought it was like a temporary.
No. Well, it depends on what you do. But yeah, it messes with the optic nerve.
But if you start with good quality wort, you're not going to end up with methanol.
No, it's in there anyway.
Yeah,
it's just that it's just part of fermentation.
It's just where
as you distill it, that's the first stuff that comes up. It boils off at a lower temperature. You get rid of that first stuff.
Hmm.
That gets rid of the methanol. Because what you're doing is just concentrating everything.
Yeah.
So as you're concentrating everything from stuff that won't hurt you, it'll a bigger percentage of what you have in there. You're gonna get a lot more methanol in there. So, but as you're redistilling it, it comes off.
Yeah. So if you're in like the backwoods somewhere and you want quantity over quality,
mm-hmm.
you're keeping all those heads and all that bullshit that's going to hurt
But the
you.
Four shots are different than the heads. So
depends
on, once those come off of there, then you're doing ethanol stuff in the middle.
Yeah.
And you take it real early and grab it really late, you're going to get more product, but it's going to have nastier flavors in it.
Welcome to the new podcast about distilling called Doing Ethanol Stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Starring Doc.
When does it make meth? does that happen in the process? Because I need to stay awake.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Nate, when's the last time you brewed?
August.
You're the brewer in the brewery.
Yeah. August, sadly. I wish it was
That's
even more sooner than
you.
That. It is a little bit, but...
And
no,
you still have like your full brewing setup? Or
I do.
Are you, okay.
Yeah, I still make a full 15 gallons every time.
Nice.
Every time I brew, give or take a few. Sometimes I'll be up and down a couple gallons depending on what I want to make. But
what did you brew?
That was nice. That was a double IPA. Back to one of the first things I ever talked about on this show back in 2008 or 9.
Yeah, that's too bad.
One of your favorite styles, Jason.
Yeah, he brought you some here.
I did, actually.
Merry Christmas.
Here you go.
Shit,
no.
That sucks.
That's long gone, thankfully, because nobody wanted to drink a 4-month-old double IPA.
Right.
But Nicole works at Alvarado Street now, and she has since January. And you guys did a great interview with those folks here a little while ago. They source great hops. And she brought some stuff home that she was super excited about. She brought home some Laurel and some Equinaut. I'd brewed with Equinaut before, but I had not brewed with Laurel.
Okay.
Laurel was really cool. It was like somewhere between like this crazy tropical, spicy berry and melon stuff that Equinaut just having a ton of oil content anyways, I felt like they amplified each other really nicely. And that was like a blend that she was just picking hops one day and was super excited about. So I was stoked to brew a double IPA with that. Thanks to those guys kicking down, I mean, a tiny amount that I need to brew.
So Nicole planned the hop blend for you?
Yeah, she did. Right. I refined the quantities. She's like, use these two. They're going to work really well together. And I was really stoked and excited about that. And the other nice thing, too, I should be bringing a lot more than I am, because she can also bring a pitch of yeast from those guys, too, which is cool.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Nice clean yeast from a brewery that's, you know, obviously great. I mean, any good clean brewery will do the trick there, but it was really nice to have that and feed that into this batch, too. I felt like that was I brewed a few times. I brewed a handful of times this year, not more than 10, sadly, but that one really stuck out to me, because that one, like, I felt like I had the best command of everything because it was so brewery fresh, like taking stuff straight from Alvarado Street. It's pretty
I feel like you cheated.
It's pretty bad, a little bit. But Laura, didn't do anything else other than drink it at home, so I guess, you know, if you're gonna cheat for your own palate, right?
Agreed. Laurel, my co-host on the Hop and Brew School podcast, Nick, is a big fan of Laurel. He's always talking about that hop.
It's cool hop. I'd never brewed with it much before. I feel like it's one that I didn't completely nail it in terms of like the absolute potential, but it was one where it wanted me to I was intrigued to try it again.
Mm-hmm.
Strata is another one that I haven't had my hands on yet that I've had a lot of beers I really like.
Yeah.
It's on my next short to-do list in terms of homebrewing that I want to brew with next. And thankfully, this being the time of year when everything is sort of becoming available, I'll probably be able to wiggle my way into a little bit of that from, you know, if not those guys from other folks. But
I could probably get you something from YCH, too.
Yeah, it'd be really super cool.
Have you used Laurel, Teresa?
Yeah, the Pink Boots blend last year
had
Laurel predominant, and it was killer.
It's not,
it was such a good beer.
And how about Strata? Have you used that?
I have not used Strata. Mm-hmm. I have not used Strata. I'm not sure I can get it in the quantity I need it this year, but I should look into it, because I agree with you. I've also had a lot of Strata beers that are just...
Yeah, there's a unique and tangible thing going on there, too, between like all the things we'd expect for American hops, that, you know, pine and citrus a little bit, but also berry and melon, just complexity.
Yeah.
Something about like an intangible complexity about that
hop. Like, it's
really
like
cool.
A lot of hops in one.
Absolutely. Yeah, kind of like Mosaico as when it first showed up. It just has so much that can bring to the table that you don't need much else other than that to make something that's really interesting. Okay. Those are obviously great. Once you can sort, I mean, the problem is, you can source those and then you're dependent on it if you're making a production beer, of course. But but when something like that comes along, it's so unique and cool, you can't, you know, ignore it when you want to make and mess around with hoppy beer. The other thing that's on my short list I want to do, I think I'm going to do this for the next week or two, is I've been trying to dial in a session roasty forward beer. Never really been found one that I've wanted to nail yet, but feel like that's a pocket that's underappreciated at the moment, and one that I really enjoy and feel like I'm enjoying more.
I mean, isn't that stout?
I want to try and hit something in like the 3 to 4 range, has like a nut, like an American, like a dialed down American style, like a little bit of maybe a Cascade,
like a roast, what a Grodzitski is to smoke beers. You want to make that for a roast?
Exactly.
I
feel like there's a pocket there that at least I would want to drink.
Hell
I could dial that in over a few iterations, that'd be pretty cool. Like a dialed-out version of Shakespeare Stout, perhaps. This is sort of where I would start. Maybe oats to sort of do mouthfeel where you didn't have alcohol.
Yeah.
And then riff off that from there and see what happens. But not beers that would sell well in the marketplace for commercial brewing, or not something that's very popular
maybe
right
not.
Now.
But, I mean, session beer, you know, lower alcohol beers are you know, gaining favor, right? So maybe a full-flavor beer like that could be something commercially viable.
I think so. I hope so. I mean, that's not a beer I can go and order as easily, right? You know, I feel like we're kind of... Yeah. And one of the reasons I homebrew less, unfortunately, is I'm spoiled.
Yeah.
I can go and get all these great beers. Like,
all of us.
Like Jeff and Eric at the Cooler is one of my neighborhood spots. I stop by and visit those guys a lot. And Arnie sources all kinds of amazing beers there. So I'm on my silly walk home from work and I have all these awesome beers. And then like Nicole works at Alvarado Street, so there's all these great beers coming from that direction.
Yeah,
No, so that's cool. But at the same time, I'm like, what's missing? Not in terms of like what's going to make money or what's the market opportunity, which is cool too. I always think about the business aspect of brewing, but like what can't I get?
Yeah.
That I want. I want roastiness in a smaller package.
In a small package.
Yeah.
Who doesn't want a smaller package?
I would love a smaller package.
Yeah. You're getting a little sweaty now. You're getting a little smelly.
Too smooth.
Like that.
That's what I've always said about what I have. It's too.
Okay.
Too smooth.
Doc, if you were going to brew a beer tomorrow, what would it be? What style?
How smooth
what style
be?
Do you want to brew?
I'd probably do a Belgian Golden.
You do a Duvel clone.
A Duvel clone, yeah.
Yeah. You're like me, man. Just stick to Old Faithful.
Some shit never changes.
You might brew a pale ale, I'm guessing.
There's no question. There are a few sure things in life.
Yeah.
That my next beer I brewed would be a pale ale is fucking one of them.
No, here's if you had your ideal brew day tomorrow.
Yeah.
Chad would brew you a pale ale.
I'm
just going to put this out here. I have a one barrel pilot system at my brewery, and are welcome every day of the week.
Thank
anytime.
Thank you, Teresa.
To brew whatever kind of beer you want to brew.
I think we need
a
to do
3%
that.
3% stout.
Let's do
a Belgian.
Let's do two brew days.
Let's do it.
We'll do Nate's fucking insane idea. When we can do a standard ass pale ale.
Yeah.
Let's do that.
Can I sleep in your parking lot?
Sleep in the parking lot.
In the RV?
I've got a spare room if someone doesn't have an RV.
I have an RV.
I've got a friend who's got goats in the backyard. You can sleep with the goats if you want.
Doc likes goats.
Sounds evil. I like
I'll
that.
Sleep in your spare room, please.
Seriously.
I will sleep in the RV.
Although you realize I have three children. You won't sleep.
It's fine. Don't worry about it.
I think we should do this.
Yeah.
I would really, really love it.
You would?
So would I.
Are you sure? You know what you're getting yourself into?
Thank you. No, this would be awesome.
Yes.
Let's do it.
You want to pick a date right now?
Yes.
Let's pick a date right now.
Let me get my calendar out.
Tomorrow.
Let's go.
That'll work.
I will demand Taryn take a day off.
Doc, do you still have Mondays off?
Yes, I do.
So we should do a Monday non-show day, right?
Yeah.
Would that work? Or you need it to be a weekend because Taryn?
I mean, I would prefer it to be a weekend, but if we can do it sometime. Well, when were you thinking? January, February? If I give her enough time, she could probably finagle some shit.
Maybe you just bring your kid and then, you know, we just throw him in with all the other
kids.
Teresa,
come on. No. The
kid's trying
to get
it. It's all
fine.
He's trying to cop a break here.
Yeah. Don't. Let's not ruin a good thing. You don't want to mix business and pleasure. You know what I'm trying to say?
Right. How about, there's not enough days, not enough Mondays in January.
Well, we could do,
I know,
you know
and
what?
I...
We could do February because we have nothing planned, so we could set the off week, and we could just do it in February if you want.
Yeah.
That'll give everybody enough time to plan for it, and then maybe whoever's listening can come and watch us or something.
That would be so fun.
Do either, maybe if we want people to join us, we could do Sunday, February 2nd.
Let's do it.
And or the 3rd, Monday the 3rd. But maybe we should do a Sunday that would help you. Yeah. Then we can get drunk and sleep there and not leave till Monday.
I like this part.
Why don't we do it on Saturday? Why don't we do Saturday the 1st then?
It's a leap year, so February on the 29th. February 29th would be Saturday, so that could be fun.
But we're talking about February 1st, though, so I don't know
what about later in the month?
Is that
I'm trying to make it fun, okay?
All right, before we leave the studio tonight, we're going to pick a day in that weekend.
I think we should do a pilot beer, and I think we should do a big batch beer, and we'll do them all at the same time.
Oh, damn.
And we'd just be like a brew bonanza.
Well, this does sound like a brew bonanza.
I mean, I just want to be clear. I'm just going to be drinking. I'm just showing
that's
up
fine.
To drink. Okay.
Yeah. That's super cool.
Bev, yeah, so are we. Both. I mean, honestly, yeah. We're going to be like, that sounds cool, but it's going to be Nate doing everything.
Right.
And we're going, oh,
yeah, like,
I think
you know, you
got
to schedule your full staff that day, right? Because we're really not doing
it. I'm pretty sure they're going to be on board.
Okay. Yeah.
I'll be like, yeah, cool. That looks great.
Yeah. So everyone listening, the first weekend in February is probably going to happen.
There you go. Keep that in your mind.
Come join us.
Super rad.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Let's do that. Well, there we go. All right. We're getting things done around here.
Who said we procrastinate? Something. There's no way. Look at that. It's proof.
Getting it done right now. Well, Shimke, I don't know.
How's it going? How's life?
I brewed a pot of coffee this morning. Nice. So I am the most recent brewer here.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
It probably sucked.
Are you still banging that guy up in Oregon?
Oh, it ended.
It ended?
It ended, yeah.
Oh, Shimke.
You didn't know?
Justin.
I did
well,
not
I didn't
know.
Tell you, so
what's
I don't
going
know
on? Jason's clapping.
I'm trying to support the. I'm trying to support my woman.
The
my
strong,
women.
Independent woman.
Yes, I'm trying to support my women. To
oh, okay, I see.
All,
continue
right?
on.
So good Shimke, for her.
I thought he was just applauding that. The way that came out of your mouth.
I was also kind
of
doing that.
Here's what I love about asking these things of Shimke. She goes through those dudes. She don't fuck around. She
what are you talking about?
She's not like waiting around.
Kim's like grain through a mill, dude.
I've had like three boyfriends in my 33 years of existence.
Yeah,
they just last a long
boyfriends,
time.
Boyfriends, yes.
Boyfriends, yes, but dudes you're banging.
Yeah, men are like wet wipes.
That guy I was banging was my boyfriend.
Men are like wet wipes for Kim Shimke.
Did you, is this a sore subject?
Disposable?
This no, one? We're on good terms. We're on good terms.
Did you,
it basically
did you
ended
leave
because
him
of logistics.
Behind? Oh, because of the distance.
Yeah.
The long distance.
Yeah, I would have had to move to Portland, and I wasn't prepared to do that.
No, so it's in your contract. I don't know if you've read your Brewing Network contract.
Oh, you have one of those?
Yeah, I never showed it to you, but it exists.
But you signed it.
Yeah, who signed
yeah,
it?
And, yeah.
It's forged.
It's a legal
document.
It's on
document. File. Yeah.
My friend John over at the Beer Law Center made it legal.
Yeah, and, it's an illegal document. You're right.
You made a signature stamp of my own signature. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You're not allowed to leave the state.
$600 into a deep fake video of you saying, I will never leave you.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, look, I'm holding true to the contract.
Yeah. A sound mind and body.
So then are you're back on Tinder or what?
Oh, God. I'm kind of over the whole thing for the foreseeable future.
Hire a match?
Good idea.
You do this every time, too.
What do you mean every time?
Yeah,
I've had two boyfriends
like, no.
since we've known each other. Come on. Every time,
maybe three, and
possibly four,
and every time afterward, you're like, "Nah, I'm cool, just chilling," you know.
I'm doing my independent
thing. And
I have
been
doing me.
I think honestly, that's the best way to find somebody cool is to not be looking for them.
No, you have to demand.
But why do we have to find somebody?
Because it's good for the radio. How about we set you? How about we set you up on a series of Brewing Network dates?
Oh my God, that sounds like the worst idea. There's not enough mace in this world.
We need video then.
Listen,
security.
We'll let Teresa be involved, so you get a little buffer there. She gets one of the
three
votes.
She would have to be the only person involved, and she'd have to be like picking. So I don't trust anybody else in this room.
What if the dates happened in the studio on the air? Like we all sat here and I interviewed you
that
for each
That sounds like
date.
It might be entertaining for everybody but myself.
Right.
What exactly
Which
was the coffee you made this morning?
Not about you.
Yeah.
Right.
Why does everything have to be about you? I think.
Come on, here's your way out.
if I had a friend.
Oh, God.
And I was like.
His name is, I don't know, Dustin.
Let's just say
Dustin.
He had a radio show.
Yeah.
I don't know. Let's call
Let's
it about
say
wine.
His name rhymes with Ustin. If I, hypothetically.
There's no if.
Would you, if I was like, hey, you should go out with this friend of mine. You
he's
wouldn't,
older.
Would you trust me to do that?
No.
You never would. You'd be like, no way.
What Smart. If he was a doctor? Maybe a little bit older.
Yeah. Almost divorced.
Yeah, almost. So you could say he's working on himself.
Yeah. Just
Very
like
positive,
you.
Positive, yeah.
I don't
Turning
know that I'm prepared
around.
To wait for
That's
another 4 years.
Come
I'm
on.
Sorry.
There you
I'm
go.
Sorry.
There you go. Mm. Well, Kim, you know what?
Why do I need a relationship when I have you guys?
I mean, that's a good point.
Oh,
That's a valid.
That's an endearing holiday.
It's a valid
comment.
Argument.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Do you want to spend Christmas together or what?
Yeah. Are we hanging out here for Christmas?
Yeah.
We just like this.
I'll give you my sizes and you can buy me some clothes.
Yep. I'll make
no,
a
no,
ham.
No, no, no. No gifts, man. Come on.
Yeah. Right.
Damn, dude.
Dude, come on.
Wow,
what are you
guys
doing?
Are like the baggage Christmas. Like trying to sign her up.
We're the worst.
All the gifts and the awkward dinner.
Yeah.
Yeah. You get the worst of it all.
We are the brothers that Shimke never wanted.
See, it's like I am already married.
It would definitely
deal
be like
the awkwardness, yeah. the discomfort.
Yeah. Like those movies.
I want to drink afterward. Yeah. It's all the same.
We're teaching you everything you need to know about relationships. Come on.
It'd be definitely like those movies where, I answered an ad to spend a night in a haunted house. I don't know, with like five other people, and then we all get killed off slowly but surely.
Slowly.
That's what Christmas with us would be like for Shimke.
I think we should do it. We rent
I think
a cabin
we should do it too.
Somewhere cabin
down by the lake
in Richmond.
GoPros everywhere. That'd be great.
Yeah.
Teresa's backyard.
Yeah, exactly.
Or a walk-in closet.
We do have a hillbilly cabin in the backyard.
Okay, perfect. Do you still have a job? Or I thought you were like leaving your job,
you
too.
Have a job.
Yes, I'm employed.
You're employed. That's
yes.
good. Okay. Well, that's a good thing.
Kim,
no, here's the
you
thing is like all my friends around me have had like all these amazing, like life-altering experiences All within like the last 2 weeks, because of course, when it rains, it pours. Uh-huh. And I get to watch everyone else around me moving forward.
Well, you have a life-altering experience.
Yeah. Like, what do you mean? Like, they're
don't
like meeting? Like, give us an example.
One of my best friends, we've known each other for 22 years. She's pregnant with her first kid.
Okay.
My other friend got engaged, and they're moving into the house that they just bought this year, mm-hmm. at the end of this year.
And you're just listening like to that clock tick.
And here I am at the Brewing Network.
Justin?
The Brewing just chilling. Well, what's the good thing is I don't want children, so I can adopt dogs at any time.
Yeah, but it's not like it's not happening. You're choosing to not let it happen. So I'm saying empower yourself. It's not that you're just a piece of shit.
What he's saying,
you're choosing not to do it.
He's saying
that might
settle.
Be the sweetest thing you've ever said to me.
That you're not a piece of shit.
Yeah.
Well, I don't mean it.
Do you think that your standards are too high? You think that maybe you should just like settle for like something?
I mean, everybody settles.
Rhymes with Austin.
Everybody does.
I think she's afraid of success.
That's like subterranean. That's not even just settling love.
What if I'm your soulmate? What if you wake up one day and discover that I'm your...
That I'm better off single.
That's fucked up.
Yeah.
We're going to have a tough Christmas this year.
Is that in my contract?
Yeah.
It's better. Yeah. Sometimes it's better to stay a diamond in the rough.
Yeah, agreed.
Yeah.
You know, I think I'd have to say, like, when you're watching all your friends have this wonderful success in life and everything is going brilliantly, you have to realize at some level that's all bullshit.
Oh, she said
it's all bullshit.
It's Facebook
nobody's
shit.
Life
yeah, they're lying to
good.
You
mm-hmm.
So you can't even hate them and feel good because you know it's bad. Because you know it's all bad.
I mean, how many friends have you had that have this perfect life
that lived happily
and then all
ever
of a sudden,
after
they're like
zero.
Oh, you know, my husband and I haven't had sex in 10 years and we're splitting up and he's got this like huge problem.
Yeah.
You why know, would
and,
you split
and you're
up
like,
for that?
Oh my God. Like,
he was like, that's what I look
just,
for.
I was just like looking your vacation pictures in Hawaii and I couldn't cope. And
right.
There you are. Like, it's not real.
See, so if you really work hard, that true. Could be you.
That's if you work hard enough.
Yeah.
If you work hard
if
enough.
If I swipe fast enough.
You too can have an unwanted child in a bad marriage.
Yeah. That's right.
If you work hard enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Teresa's right. Everybody's a mess. Everybody's a disaster.
Oh, no, I know. I mean, it's not. It's just it's one of those things where it's like near the holidays and this is a recent thing and I didn't really want it to happen. But,
yeah.
You know.
Right.
But again, I'm telling you, it was your choice. So it should be empowering to you. It's more try to be more positive about it because you made the choice.
Like all of a sudden, JP's positive.
Is that what a therapist told you that you are now telling me?
Yeah.
Yeah. That'll be $50.
It's because JP is the devil's advocate. He needs to always turn it around.
That's
always
true.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit twisted.
Oh, dear.
Know, that didn't end.
Like the
since
Joker.
The last time we were around each other. That's great.
So what are you doing for the holidays? You going to go visit the parents?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, my parents just moved to Tucson.
Great. Oh. So you're going to spend Christmas in Tucson.
Here. Yeah.
So, sorry, I'm laughing. I've been to Tucson.
So you're going to come
great.
Back with a shaved head
really.
And a heroin problem. That's what's going
to
happen.
You want me to drive you there in the RV? We could be
no.
together.
Nope.
We could be together.
We could be together.
That was
we
quick.
Should spend our holidays together, but separate.
You think so?
You know?
Do you want to
like, send a text? And say, like, happy holidays.
What if we FaceTime the whole time?
FaceTime, live tweet to each other the whole time.
You can meet my parents.
I would love to meet your parents.
So you met my mom.
Oh, I did meet your mom. Your mom's awesome.
You met her for like 10 minutes.
Is she single?
Is she hot?
She's married to my dad.
Mm.
So, we talked about that. So, why don't you just show up in Tucson in the RV?
I am. It's actually already planned. I've been talking with your mom, and turns out you're sleeping on the couch this year.
Yeah. You know the smoked ham you guys are going to have for dinner? It's Justin.
I made it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well,
Someone on
I'm
Twitter,
a little worried about you.
Reminded me or said that February 2nd is a Super Bowl. I'm sorry for that weird segue. I thought you were ending the thing.
That's
can't
a good,
be that weekend.
True. That's a
for
bad,
who?
That's a bad weekend.
Well, I don't know. I feel like the last thing that Teresa's Brewery wants to have is 400 RVs in their parking lot for the Super Bowl weekend.
And then it's SF Beer Week after that. So we should look again. We should look instead at like the 23rd,
like
24th.
Kim said.
Or we should do the leap year, like Kim said.
No, that's still the same weekend. That's
so
still Super Bowl weekend.
No,
29th
of February
is not the 2nd of February.
The 23rd, we have Cousins Maine Lobster.
No.
What does that mean?
That means there's
good.
Maine Lobster
what month
food truck.
Hell yeah. I want some Maine lobster.
And you know, I'm actually a fan of doing it later in the month because I'm out of town that first week.
Oh, okay.
I just realized.
There you go.
All right, we'll figure this out.
So maybe we should do it on the 29th.
Justin, you're in January. We're talking about February.
Oh, dude, you know what? We definitely should do it on the 29th because
it only happens once every.
There is karaoke at Crooked Lane on February 29th, and I'm judging.
All right.
Oh. Yes. Well, we got to work. Oh, my God. Do a duet.
I'm in. Let's do it. I'm in.
Okay, let's go. 29th. We're there.
That's a good. All right.
It's going to be epic.
Okay.
I'm just telling you.
It's actually going to be
right
Crooked
now.
Lane. Epic's
it's going to be super epically Crooked Lane.
What do I have to do to enter the karaoke competition?
You have to show up with your body and tell the
and
person
put my name
to
in.
Put your
fucked
name
already.
In.
Yeah. Fuck. Yeah.
It's pretty easy.
Okay.
But there's prizes.
Okay.
So we do.
I will do it.
I'm going to have to practice between now and then.
We'll make sure you make it there.
Yeah.
You know,
in
it's
prime
best
condition.
You don't really practice.
I'm ready for it.
Off of cuff sort of thing.
I can definitely get that time off.
I have seen Nate karaoke before, by the way, and it is awesome.
Hell yeah.
Grand Rapids, Michigan.
That's true. That was fun.
Yes.
I was just about to bring that up. Yes.
Nicole
would be in on this whole idea too, if you remember correctly. She was also on that same stage.
That's true. And Sam tried to show you up by doing Holy Diver.
He did, actually.
No, he did not.
Yeah. He did so. Yes.
Oh,
and he did
Lord
share.
Have mercy.
He also did share in the same sitting.
Sam's
go to right now is if you don't know me
by now.
That's his go to right now, but like it's
can
glorious.
I just say that I just caught Kim Shimke staring off into the distance in sorrow?
Oh.
You
want
me wishing she was more on your level? Is that what you're hoping
for? I'm telling
you,
I should have snapped a photo because you were just staring
longingly
off in sadness. I told
do that
you,
all
I'm
the
worried
time.
About you.
She got this faraway
that's
look.
That's been 33
she
years
didn't.
Of my lifetime. Mm.
She did not want to see any of us doing karaoke. That was that was what that looked
well, that's
was.
That's just it, is I was thinking of the song,
right.
Which I have a great one.
But you know what
we're
going
to dedicate all the songs to Shimke when we do it.
Auburn and karaoke.
What does it mean?
Andy Wood.
Oh, yeah. Andy Wood.
Oh, yeah.
100%. Yeah.
He'll own it.
He will win
like he
karaoke.
Does.
He will win karaoke.
Andy Wood is the greatest karaoke singer / kindergarten principal you've ever met.
Ever to grace the
planet
Earth.
Yeah,
he's a performer.
It's disappointing
absolutely.
How good he is.
You'll probably get some Alanis Morissette from him. Maybe a little... I don't know.
Oh, didn't he do some Zeppelin last time?
Oh God, he did.
Oh, really?
He did Black Dog.
Yeah,
nice.
Oh,
yes,
that's awesome.
He nailed it.
Wow.
We already know who is going to win this karaoke competition. Actually,
I don't know. There is one chick that showed up a couple times, and she's got the pipes, man. She is awesome. But
Andy will destroy her.
Honestly, there is no there's prizes for like best performance.
Uh-huh.
You know. Best song,
right?
But also like most awkward and terrible.
What about best?
Oh, Sam will win that.
What about best performance by a recently single woman? Is that a category?
Seeing as how I'm judging, like you know,
you gotta in, Shimke.
But there was a dude who was getting really visibly upset because somebody was not adhering to the words that were on the screen.
Oh, good Lord.
Wow.
Yeah, last time we almost had to boot somebody for being like a karaoke tool.
He's like the rules lawyer riot there in the front row.
I was
like,
what the fuck, dude? Like, what's the problem?
You're not sticking to the words.
Was it Warren?
It does sound like a beardy. No. Imagine being kicked out of a place that, like, I'm blackballed from there. Why? Well,
I didn't feel like singing the words.
It was this karaoke night, and I was really mad that they weren't singing the words right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was. Everyone else was wrong. And you ever been in a room full of wrong people?
Mm-hmm.
It's not fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think it was very confusing. Somebody, one of the brewers, was back there, and he's a big guy. And my colleague was like, "Hey, dude, like, shut that guy down." And he's like, "I don't understand. What is the problem?"
Oh no, gosh.
Yeah, but you know, we told that guy to chill.
All right. Well,
and
looks like that's our date. That's our night. It's a date, Shimke. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, the date with the Brewing Network, the whole group of us together.
Everything you've ever always wanted.
No one-on-ones whatsoever.
At least you won't be lonely.
That's right.
We can all punish you simultaneously with bad conversation. It'll be great. You'll love it.
See?
It's like every time I show up here.
Ooh.
Hey, Doc.
Yeah.
Do you manscape?
The top of your head.
I had an accident once, so.
I got just the thing for you, actually. Just the thing for you.
That's how Doc was circumcised.
So Manscaped has solved the I had an accident once problem with their all-new Perfect Package 2.0. That's right.
Perfect Package
2.0. Manscaped has redesigned the electric trimmer. Their Lawnmower 2.0 has proprietary advanced skin-safe technology so that you won't nick or snag your sack while using it, and I've proven it.
Oh, yeah? I saw a commercial on that today, just today.
You did?
Yep. Same product?
It works. So I had to go to the emergency room for my balls not too long ago, and I needed to shave, and I had them. It was the first time using my Manscaped trimmer, and I got skin close, no nicks.
So, you know, they do it for you, just to let you know.
I know, but that's what I was worried about, and the whole experience, I'm glad I did it, because the whole experience was already uncomfortable and awkward enough that I'm glad they didn't also have to shave me. Thanks to Manscaped.
Okay, good.
So, have you gotten yours yet, JP? You don't manscape anymore now that you're married.
No,
child,
I would totally do it. I was waiting for you to give me one for free, but now I gotta buy one.
It's Christmas time. Mine.
Yeah, but I don't want yours.
I told you can borrow mine anytime.
That's weird. That's like if I went to go to Kim Shimke's family for Christmas next year. I don't want to go there after you did.
It's true.
You know?
Yeah, that's a good that, when you put it that way. Yeah. The Lawnmower 2.0 comes inside the Perfect Package 2.0, which is a perfect gift for this holiday season. It's everything you need to keep trimmed, cut free, and smelling nice down there because it has the Crop Reviver. I used the Crop Reviver last week.
Really?
Yeah. And it's like they're wipes, but they have like a nice scent, and you can just like clean up down there without having to jump in the shower.
Right.
Which is great because I'm way too lazy to jump in the shower. And then they also have, what's the other one called? It's like a Crop Preserver.
That's right, Crop Preserver, baby. You gotta
so that
preserve
you,
that
you
shit.
You put that on there, and then it'll keep you preserved and smelling nice. You can go to manscaped.com and use coupon code BREWING. You get 20% off plus free shipping right now. Go to manscaped.com. If you've got that special someone in your life and you want to hint to them that, like, some scaping is... you know, like, that it's important to you. Like, yeah. I feel like couples don't talk about this very well. And, like, sometimes you like a person a lot, right?
Correct. Sometimes.
Yeah, and you like them a lot, and maybe they live far away, and that seems like the problem. Mm-hmm. But the problem really is that you're unhappy with the care of their junk down
yeah,
there.
Yeah, right.
Because a lot of people who live in Oregon are very, like, they just let things grow. They're very lumberjacky.
Well,
I think
sure. Well, yeah.
Hippie-like.
You don't want to interfere with Mother Nature.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
However, maybe your significant other would prefer if you cleaned up a little mm-hmm. bit. So if that's the case, you could save an entire relationship
correct.
By gifting them the Manscaped Perfect Package 2.0.
I think you're right.
Shimke, do you have any thoughts on this?
Hypothetical.
Sorry,
question.
I wasn't paying attention. I was too lost in sorrow. I wasn't following. Mm.
Yeah, I thought so.
Drowning in tears over here.
You probably could have got a whole nother year out of that relationship.
If you had only gifted the Manscaped 2.0. Lives well, far away.
Yeah, well, the beauty of the Manscaped 2.0 is you can just go ahead and shave your significant other while they're asleep.
And they won't know.
And they won't know.
You won't nick them.
You won't nick them. They won't right. bleed to death. You won't have to imagine that 911 call. I was just trying to save my relationship.
Yeah.
My boyfriend, wanted me to move.
You imagine waking up to some crazy girl
this,
fucking
this
shaving
is, I mean, I'm doing a little JP here, but this is
first.
Very unlikely
is
that
not?
Someone's going to stay asleep through this process.
Yeah, it's better than true. Waking up and they got a pair of scissors.
That's true.
Yeah. I'd much rather them have the Lawnmower 2.0 than a pair of scissors.
Oh, yeah.
I want someone to lawnmower me. I don't want someone to Lorena Bobbitt me. There's a big difference.
Yeah. Go to manscaped.com. Use coupon code BREWING. Get that gift for that special hairy someone in your life. Manscaped.com. Okay. Have I done all the things?
I don't know. It feels like you have. And that's really all that matters.
Yeah, it feels good to me, too.
Yeah. I love it. I feel good about it.
Well, I want to thank you guys for joining us back in the studio, Doc.
Yeah, sure.
And Nate.
Happy holidays. Thank you.
We'd have Twitter game.
Oh.
We can run through that with everybody.
We had today's boring Twitter game.
Whoa.
Ouch.
Riveting.
Wow.
Today's riveting.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Look, how can you know pleasure
undeniably
if you don't know pain,
fun,
right? So
Twitter
how can
game.
You know funny if you don't know, you know, stupid?
Our Twitter game today is like dating Shimke.
That's right.
Plain and boring.
Very boring, and nobody wants to do it for very
long.
Oh
my gosh, that is so hurtful.
You guys are all fired.
Just like Kim Shimke's boyfriend, you want to get out of this game as fast as possible.
Oh no. Yeah. Just like Shimke's boyfriend could not be far enough away. Today's Twitter game.
Just like Shimke's boyfriend. That should be, that's going to be, you know what? That'll be my next Twitter game.
That's how I like my boyfriends. Very far away.
Very far away. Emotionally, sexually, physically.
Yeah, I thought
most
this
importantly,
was the
physically.
One for you. I thought it ticked off all the leave me alone
I did
boxes.
Too. I did too.
Turns out he wanted to be around you more, and that sealed the deal.
That's right.
That's where it got problematic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That
I'm sorry, you
and
like
his hairy
me too
bush.
Much? Oh, well, then. If you like me, what's your judgment like? Now I know you are an insane person because you actually want to spend more time with me, another equally insane person.
Can we change today's Twitter game to who should Kim Shimke date that works at the Brewing Network?
Oh, man.
Teresa, you're in an open
aren't
marriage,
you,
right?
How Kim, aren't you happy you showed up today? This is just lovely, wonderful.
I feel like this
you.
Is a trap.
Yeah,
when I was
I'm
invited.
Really sorry, yeah. I didn't know anything
I feel
about
like Bev
this.
Is the only answer.
I was like,
I am the
like,
only
Bev,
answer.
Listen,
yeah,
invite,
so me
invite
and Bev,
Shimke,
yeah.
And then just go ahead and invite Nate and Doc so that it looks like it's like a whole like a reunion
yeah.
show.
It's right. A little bit, then then the truth will come out.
Yeah,
it won't look like quite the ambush.
All right, what was our Twitter game today?
If you could learn a skill, what would it be?
Manscaping.
Tell me that some of the answers were...
They were good. Okay. They were pretty good. Don't worry about it.
Manscaping is it.
Manscaping. Dude, thank you, Don. That was amazing.
Don wins.
You just hand out cards, professional manscaper.
Oh, yeah. My gay friends have a guy. And they swear by him. He's very talented, I guess.
Sure. I mean, it's, you know, sure.
He's professional.
Fuck it.
All right.
He doesn't use the scissors.
You know.
What skills did we get? If you all were going to learn any skill, what would it be? That was the Twitter game, right?
Sure, yeah. Someone called Kim, I don't know, maybe Kim Shimke, who's to say, said sobriety.
That's a skill?
Apparently.
I feel like it's a curse.
I don't know, Kim.
That's unattainable.
That's one answer that's more boring than the question.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Teresa. All right.
Yeah, I'm gonna second that one.
It's a compliment.
Is that a skill or?
Sure, man. I don't know. Okay. I don't ask Shimke. She fucking wrote it. Josh says how to tell jokes about Chechnya.
Okay.
That's a skill.
That is a skill. Not right. Everybody has it.
No. In Chechnya, we have one skill. We share. Kent says to understand water chemistry. And I had to put it in because we talk about home brewing.
The man is serious.
So I get it. So
he's got Palmer's book in his hand. He's like, I'm just gonna learn this one.
With
of these
a glazed
days.
Look on his face.
An account called The Hop Grenade.
Okay.
Whoever does the Hop Grenade social.
Huh. I've heard of that before.
Tact.
Tact.
Yeah. And I feel like I know who it is, but I don't know who it is, and it's just this is what it is. So tact.
I want to know who from the Hop Grenade wrote that. Was it this Hop Grenade or Colorado Hop Grenade?
Well, I don't know. Do you guys, it's at the Hop Grenade.
Huh.
Somebody outside.
So who has access and who is on right now monitoring the feed?
And who thinks we don't have tact?
No. I think they
Kim
would,
Shimke.
They would want to learn tact. I don't think it's about reflected at us. It's reflected about them. I think it's like psychosomatic, psycho.
I see.
Psycho.
Projection. It's projection.
There you go.
Got it. Okay.
Okay. Our very own code writing fool chimed in. We never hear from Code anymore, but I'm glad to see he's still monitoring the wavelengths.
Yeah, I fucked this up. Go on. I'll tell you in a second.
Tuvian throat singing.
Nice.
I think it's Tuvian where they go like... The guy from the Pixies learned...
Is that with a V or a B?
Tuvian. Yeah.
Throat singing.
Yeah.
Code did some... voiceovers for us that I was supposed to play, like edit and play. It's like
you
a thing.
I
didn't because I was gone all weekend and I was late today. And then I told him I'd get it done before the end of the year. So he should learn Tuvian throat singing.
He should.
Okay. You like leave your computers on over the holidays. I'll be in there.
How many more do we have?
Three.
Wow.
Four.
Whoa.
Joel writes pole dancing without breaking my foot.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Too soon.
That was mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Too soon.
It is around that time of year.
Yeah.
That's true.
It was a very stripper Christmas.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. I should have brought the pole out for you.
The Brewer of Seville says, I'd love to learn how to convince my wife to let me travel around the Pacific Northwest, quote, scouting a place to open a distillery while she stays home and continues to work and support the family.
Beardy does have a good skill going.
I think I'll seek out the master of deception, Mr. Warren Beardy Billups.
Yeah, it's a good call. Like, really, what every time I text him, he's, what are you doing? I'm playing poker.
Yeah.
Smart man.
Two more. Someone called Smiling Retard.
Why did we get more answers to the worst Twitter game of the year?
Because it's secretly the best Twitter game of the year.
Okay. Secretly.
I'm offended by that.
Smiling
name.
Retard says self suck.
Oh.
Man.
Same.
Okay.
I actually have pictures of a guy doing
that. Oh, like, of course you do.
Really?
How do you take a selfie doing self suck?
I didn't selfie it.
I mean,
I was just there.
Manscaped or not?
Yeah, actually.
Wow. That's what happens when you make 20 burns.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He's the repeat customer, too.
And then last but not least, Zach says, how to win this dumb Twitter game and not have a prize sent to me by Bevo. Suck a JP.
I'm not even writing.
I don't even know what that means.
That's
I just
rude.
Wanted to
I
be
send
rude
prizes.
To Bevo. Yeah. Oh. All right, so there you go. That's it.
Hmm.
Not bad. I mean, you know, it's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like the Manscaped one. Yeah. I vote Doc.
Yeah, Doc's was good. I'm going to write that down instead of the last one. Manscaping.
The skill.
Okay.
Huh. So my top ones here are how to tell jokes about Chechnya.
Chechnya. Mm-hmm. I don't even think it's a Chechen accent. I think it's just...
In Chechnya, all boyfriends are long distance.
They 6 feet under where we put them as women.
Yeah. Thank you.
In Chechnya, we hold on to boyfriend by burying in 6 foot ground. We make them dig themselves.
Mine.
Yeah.
Mine.
We threaten them with sex.
Happily,
jump right in.
Happily ever after.
I say, I will sex you, and they jump in immediately.
I like tact.
You can't have the hop grenade win.
I'm not sending anybody from the hop grenade a shirt.
Okay.
I want to know who it was. Who thinks they lack tact? Who's self-aware enough to think that they lack tact?
It's a cry for help.
It is a cry for help.
I need help. I need tact. I think
does
I'll
Scott
learn
use the Twitter?
Yeah.
Oh.
Sort of what I was... Beth is the Kool-Aid man.
Yeah.
Crashing through the wall.
Hi! Do you guys think it's Scott?
Oh, yeah.
Does anybody here else think it's Scott?
You know, on the count of he doesn't have tag.
No, that was not. I was just trying to get into the mind of the person asking the question, and I feel like he would think that we don't have tact and then be answering it in the sense of we should be
Jesus Christ.
Acquiring tact.
We should work for the Trump campaign.
I like it,
Jesus.
I like it better the way I said it.
Beth's going to get hired by Rudy Giuliani tomorrow.
Projection and ricochet and projection once again.
Guys, I just want to wonder out loud if it's Scott.
He hates social media. I thought you were going to be like, no, that's not Scott.
Yeah, but he's talking about himself, so he'll love it.
Okay, that's way worse than what I said.
Yeah, sorry. All right, what else we got, Jay? Are we going to kill ourselves tonight?
I like pole dancing without the broken foot.
Me too.
I like travel.
I do too.
Especially the last part.
Yeah. Right. I like travel the Pacific Northwest while your wife works. That's a skill.
Yeah,
that's a skill. Manscaping is my favorite one though, still.
You want to have Doc win?
It's pertinent.
Well, Doc can win, and then we can give the prize to the runner to a runner up.
Okay,
that works.
Bam.
All right, so Manscaping, Doc, that's our winner. Hey. Well played. Go to manscaped.com. Yeah. Use coupon code Brewing.
I retweet as winner, I'll put an asterisk.
What do you like, JP, as your runner up?
Stupid ass video game or what? What?
What?
Twitter game.
Twitter game.
I'm thinking about video games.
Charity at home, Jason?
To be honest, I do like self-suck only because it's funny and I want to agree.
It's disgusting.
I want to agree with.
Is that a wish fulfillment vote for you?
Yeah. Well, I like I like being able to say the word retard and not have to feel guilty about it because it's the guy's account name. So what am I going to do?
What was the account name again?
Smiling Retard.
That's aggressive.
Can you say that again?
No, I can't. and then, so I don't know, man. I think, I don't know, man. Honestly, I'm going to say this out loud on the record. I think Kim's was kind of all right. I think that was pretty good.
Sobriety?
Yeah.
That's a sympathy vote. I don't want that sympathy vote. Oh, okay.
Also, it's terrible.
Yeah, you know.
It's not funny.
Have you tried
it's
that
not
before?
Fun or funny?
It's just sad.
Fun or funny?
Yeah. I don't even want to try it.
Joel, pole dancing. Let's win. He's
That's
a winner.
Your...
Let's sure. Fuck it. Let's go.
Does anybody else have a favorite runner-up? Anybody?
I'm down with pole dancing.
You like pole dancing?
Is there a story here? Did someone break a foot pole dancing?
Oh, my God.
Oh,
really?
Teresa.
Oh, there's a good one there, Teresa.
Teresa.
We'll help you out here.
So this is the problem with my life is I'm not sure I have enough time
to
catch up on all the deets.
Oh, yeah.
So
we
guys
got
have
this
to, like, fill me
thing.
In.
We can narrow it down to about 4 or 5 episodes you should listen to. I think probably like, more like one or two.
That would actually really help.
I can think of one episode you can entirely skip.
Well, there's that.
Not this. Years
That's
ago.
That's my foot.
What?
That's my foot.
That's Doc's foot.
This is a pole dancing.
This has never been able, and I share the dumbest content.
All the time.
I've never been able to pull up a photo that quick.
Doc knows what ails
so,
him.
Years ago, in our first studio, which was in a garage.
2007, I would say. Right?
No, it was seven.
End of seven.
We installed a stripper pole. Okay. The irony of the situation.
As you do.
Because why wouldn't you?
The irony of the situation is that Doc installed.
It was a cheap one.
The handy man.
Yeah. Spring loaded.
Yeah.
And we just thought it'd be funny to have it. And then we didn't really use it on air. It had gotten.
Oh, no.
It got used off air. Well, until
people would dance a little bit. Oh, yeah.
Until this show, it had only gotten like off air use by like.
I thought I put it up.
Schumann.
I thought I put it up that. Day.
Could have been. Oh, okay. Maybe
I think
so.
It's like before the show.
We decided to do our end of the year show, like this one, was called A Very Stripper Christmas. And I forced Bevo to dress in lingerie.
Basically, at knife point.
It was a nightgown. Like, let's be clear.
It was pink.
It was not nightgown.
No, it was, like modest lingerie.
No.
Not
it covered
really.
Everything.
Yes. Well, yeah. I mean, there were garters, but...
There
and was then,
no garters.
Yeah, pajamas.
I had
it wasn't pajamas. It was...
In my mind,
look,
PJs.
It was like
when
the,
I replay it, it's garbage.
First of
okay.
all, I was very young. Second of all, I didn't even get paid, so
I know.
Hey, I've been on stripper before.
You were
no
hammered,
judgment.
Though,
and I might have been hammered.
It did,
you were hammered. You were
it
hammered.
Did prompt this philosophical question from Bevo. Why do I do
everything
that Justin asks me to do?
Why?
And I was like,
it was like a turning
because
point.
You're awesome. So most of us took a turn on the stripper pole that evening.
Also, I didn't take any of my clothes off. And I just want to be clear.
No. Okay. That's correct.
When it got to Doc's turn...
I didn't know we were taking turns.
Being the overachiever that he is, he felt that if he climbed all the way to the top of the of said pole and spun around...
Yeah.
That it would be an epic dance.
Like legit pole dance.
Well,
and it
remember,
was.
I said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. And everybody's cheering. We had a lot of people in the studio, and they're cheering. I'm going to get hurt. And he says, no, we're not going to get hurt. Okay, fine.
Famous last words.
Yeah. So, you know, Doc's not the tallest person on the planet. So when he was at the top of the pole spinning around, he was fairly high off the ground.
I mean, they were, what, 10-foot ceilings probably in the garage.
Yeah.
It's a long way for me.
Yeah, exactly. Mid-twirl, the pole became detached from the ceiling.
Oh, my God.
And then Doc...
I was hurling towards the people on the couch.
Fell toward the ground, catching himself with his heel on a thinly veiled concrete floor, basically.
And I snapped my heel bone.
Couch
dwellers did not... throw your bodies underneath him.
He was too far away, and he was too far gone. And we were too impressed.
It happened really fast.
By the move.
Yeah. Well, we were all behind the desk anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. We were just sitting there giving him space, giving the boy space.
We just even the fall was just seemed funny at the time until we later realized he landed in just the right way.
Sorry, and it wasn't a big catastrophic fall. It was just happened to hit it just right.
His heel.
Yeah, I mean, because I think physically you actually landed on the couch, but you tried to break your fall with your heel, and then what was the story you told your wife when you went home?
Retaining wall, dude.
For the record, he slipped off the retaining wall in the backyard.
Yeah. Yep. Your Honor. Yeah. Yes.
Well, for 2 days I didn't know it was broken.
Really?
So I ended up at the doctor, and I saw the x-ray. I could tell right away. Then go to see the orthopedic surgeon. Yeah, you need the surgery. Yeah, you need foot surgery and be wearing a boot. I'm thinking, oh, cool. People wear a boot for 6 weeks. No, I wore a boot for 6 months.
Yeah, it was a big thing.
I was on crutches for 6 months and everything else.
Yeah, there's a lot of screws in that picture.
Yeah. I asked him, what'd you have to use the whole box? You just open the box. There's 10 screws and 2 plates in there. Still really? In there.
There's also a like 4-megapixel flip phone camera video somewhere in the internet.
It wasn't a flip phone. Yeah. It was a Palm Pilot, if you forget the turn of the phrase. I don't know where that is. I
learned your graffiti
on
the Palm Pilot, bro.
Thanks. The internet's forever.
It's like 16-bit also.
So to this day, Doc actually still holds the record for most injured brewcaster ever.
It's true.
That's true.
Yay.
Yeah.
Knock on wood.
Badge of honor.
Yeah.
Physically injured. Yeah. A lot of emotional injuries.
Until February 29th, when we elect a new candidate.
Oh, no. Yeah.
Kim wins for emotionally injured. Doc wins for physically injured.
Yeah. Obviously. What? Yeah.
Works for me.
I mean, think of it that your heel is now stronger than it was before.
Yeah, kind of like bionic. And
exactly.
Metal reinforced there.
Okay. Well, now that we've told the story, our runner-up/winner is the skill I would like to learn is pole dancing without the broken foot.
There we go. Good job, Joel.
Yeah, well done.
See, and you thought it was a dumb game.
Yeah.
I mean, it was, but...
I mean, I am surprised that we got that many answers. But I'm pleasantly surprised, JP.
Well, that's my favorite kind of surprise.
Hate it when I don't like the Twitter game, too, I can tell. It bothers you.
Well, yeah, a little bit. Well, it used to bother me a lot more, but now, I mean, a little bit, sure.
They can't all be home
runs. Who doesn't want to be, funny on the
They can't all be home runs, but I will admit this game played out very well.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would like to say that I knew that would happen.
One of the longest games running on the BN.
It's true.
So there you go.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think that does it for us. We've got to get to Vinny so we can set Shimke up with a new date.
Vinny.
Monday night at Vinny's, I find, is like prime date material.
For picking up guys?
Shimke. For picking up guys, I have found, yeah.
All right, good.
I mean, I go home with a guy at least every other Monday.
Hell yes!
from Vinny. Teresa, you've been to Monday night Vinny's. You're aware
It was really awesome. Like the the bands were phenomenal.
Phenomenal. Yeah.
Can't think of a better word.
Phenomenal.
Phenomenal.
They were actually called Phenomenal. That was the band. Yeah.
Oh, I love it. They were phenomenal.
They didn't know that though, because they were tripping balls.
Yeah,
there was some drumming. It was random yet delightful.
Lovely.
Hell yeah, dude.
Nate, thanks for being here.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Doc, thanks for coming out.
Of course.
It's good to see you. Shimke, did we finally succeed in offending you after all these years you've been with us?
I mean, I'll probably be back next month. Yeah. I got nothing better to do.
There we go.
Okay, good.
Gaslit the shit out of her.
Yeah, we did.
Now
yeah.
I have one less thing that I'm focused on, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You target all those other important things in your life.
Yeah.
You need to take up bingo or something.
That's right.
So I'll see you at Christmas. I can't wait to see Mom again.
Yeah, Mama.
I've packed already, but all I packed was pajama bottoms.
And a manscaper?
And my manscaper and my house shoes. That's it.
Go visit Warren. He needs the company more than I do.
You think?
I don't think so.
No.
Yeah. I think he's doing fine.
He's busy playing poker.
Beardy's living a dream right now. You know.
Oh, yeah. Life is really working.
Yeah.
Just working every day. It's hard work.
All right, folks, we are not back on the air until 2020. That's right. Bevo tried to misle us and book a show before she was supposed to.
I mean, I just figured we had to, whatever.
No.
It's
on
fine.
What, the 30th?
I hope you dressed her down. I hope you, like, really,
on
you know.
This, like,
gave it to her.
I sent an unkind text.
Okay, good.
I just said...
I wasn't any different than the normal text you sent. I was just like, oh, okay, I'll fix this, whatever.
I basically just said, fix this.
All right.
So we will be back on air with you on January 13th. We're going to go enjoy the holiday season.
Mm-hmm.
By we, I mean Shimke and I. We're going to go enjoy the holiday season.
All right.
Separate location.
Yeah.
Two different locations in Tucson.
Live blog about it, though.
I'm going to live blog about it. I'm just going to follow Shimke for days and days and days. Yeah. Yeah. I've already gotten
You should be there before she shows up.
I'll just have the sign at the airport that says Shimke just waiting in the baggage claim area. Can you imagine?
Yes.
Yep. Don't check any luggage.
We're so tempted right
now.
We're off for the holidays. We'll be back on January 13th. To you and yours, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, all the whatever.
Whatever you want me to say, I've said it.
Yeah. Enjoy your families and your friends. If you're a dentist, don't off yourself. This is the time of year that dentists tend to, not you, but dentists, like,
really?
They're the number one group and during the holidays.
Really?
So if you're a dentist, other than Doc, too, you know,
Doc's
don't
Teflon. There's
nothing
be nice
to yourselves. Love yourselves out there.
That's right.
Yeah, didn't you ever read that stat?
No.
It's this time of year.
Why?
And dentists in general.
Why?
They get
nobody knows.
They get punished by all those people trying to cash in their end-of-year benefits.
Nobody
they
knows.
They all want to deluge the dentist's office.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, take care of yourselves. JP, take us out of here. Merry Christmas, everybody.
I'm glad we could say that again.
Yeah, whatever.
Thank you to our show sponsor, More Beer. You can get absolutely everything you need to make great beer at home by going to morebeer.com. Dr. Charlie Bamforth came into the studio. We aren't sure why he still likes us, but he does. You can find his books on Amazon, taste his impact at Sierra Nevada, and read his writings about the Wolverhampton Wolves over at wolvesheroes.com. Do you have extra money? If so, head over to patreon.com/earsup and support JP in his quest to become supported monetarily by the likes of you. If you love Twitter and Homebrew, follow Nate Smith at Nathan Homebrew, Mike McDowell at Tasty McD, and you can unfollow Warren at Another Beardy. Our newest brewcaster, Teresa, is online at Pasuti Brews and Crooked Lane Brewing. Keep track of JP over on Instagram at Major Jip, and you can find Bebo there as well at Beverly M. Moore. Be sure to find the Brewing Network on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Yeah. JP's an asshole. Justin's a nice guy and winning the race. JP does great as his charity can.